Good morning to one and all present here. On behalf of staff members and members of managing committee, once again I extend a warm welcome to Shri Ramachandran and his teammates and all the parents present here today. We know that now everyone has to lead a very stressful life, and it is the most difficult task to handle the children. So, in today's world, how to handle the stress at parents' level, at teachers' level, at students' level, and at individuals' level. So, we will get valuable tips from Mr. Ramachandran, who is the representative of ISKCON Temple. And they are spreading this message across so that the students or we do not get stressed, and we will definitely get valuable advice how to deal with the stress.
Hare Krishna. First and foremost, it's okay. First and foremost, I would request all of you all to come a little closer towards me so that I can shout a little less. Please, it's a humble request. Please, all of you, move ahead. There's a lot of, you know, we have all been lord of the last benches. Now, let's be lord of the first benches. I think sure it should be, because yeah, you're right. Thank you. No, in fact, I have to mute this. So I think now you all settle down for a small Vedic session. First and foremost, I'd like to thank you all for sparing the Saturday morning, you know, from your hectic schedule, taking out some time. Thank all the parents for having attended, coming for attending this session. By the way, I would like to know from the parents, what do you expect from this session? I would like to know from you all, what is your idea or concept of you will be getting from this session? By the way, can I identify who are the parents? Can you please raise your hands? At least I will know who are the staff and who are the parents. Oh, that's great. So, what do you think? What are you expecting from us? What is the expectation that what you are expecting from this today's workshop or seminar? What you are you expecting of this? Yeah, but you must have heard of a lot of stress management classes which are run on general platform. But this one is unique because it's running on a Vedic platform. This is what the Vedas are saying and which is already existing. It's not something new invented or concocted by today's modern day science. This has been mentioned in the Vedas 5000 years before. It has been mentioned. Lord gives in the second chapter the peace formula, the formula by which one can be peaceful and happy. Now, slowly we will start the session so that slowly we will get an idea of the feel of the things. Paisa, biggest source of happiness, right? Right from childhood, for every child, we teach the process of how to earn money. That's the one thing which is like it's injected in the blood from the day one. Money will make us happy. And so for that, I don't know how much of torture we undergo. Just for this success and happiness, we study, we get married, we work for offices, and finally we get good cars, good planes, skyscrapers, gadgets. And mind you, what is the end result of all this? We see in 1990, the TVs are flat. TVs are fat and people were slim. Today, in 2008, TVs have become slim and people have become fat. So this is what is the advancement we have got. Earlier TVs were flat, but so we were having more time, children were having more time to play, have some physical exercise and all that. But nowadays, slim TVs, children sitting and watching those TVs and they are going fatter and fatter day by day. America, countries, the European countries, the goal for all our children, we educate our children. I think many children are given birth to serve America. We want our children to grow up and go to America. That's the final goal, as if that's the end of this world, end of the earth. Okay, that's some way go. Okay, it's good to some respect, but not the end of it. We think if my child reaches the US or the European countries, he is going to be happy. No doubt. They are the most dissatisfied, full of anxiety and unhappy, totally unhappy people. It's not that they are happy. Don't have an impression that, you know, Western countries, they have reached the summit of advancement and they are happy. No. The maximum number of US prison rate, if you see, the population has increased from 8 lakhs to 80 lakhs in just 10 years. In around 90 or 95, it was around 8 lakhs. And in 2007, it is showing 80 lakhs. Gun sales have increased, and good increase in communal violence, terrorism, of course. Today we all are facing this problem, and total unrest. The whole world is in unrest. We may feel it's peaceful, but it's total unrest. It's a boon. We are happy, we are lucky that we are born in India. Just imagine if you had been born in Syria, what you'd be undergoing, you would be undergoing over there. The fate, the torture what you would be undergoing in the Gulf countries, had you been born over there. Okay, it's the mercy of the Lord and because of your past karmas that you are born in India. A country like India. A country where even a rupee note is valued. Show me which foreign country values a foreign rupee, one rupee note. If it falls down, they just pick it up. But even today, in 2016, if a rupee or a 10 rupee note falls down, we take it up and put it in our eyes, put it on our forehead. This is the respect we give. Everything is spiritual in this country. This country is spiritual right from the point one to the point end. But slowly, the Western culture is killing it. That's the tragedy. We have to understand that Western culture is slowly killing this tradition, and finally, we are landing up in a stressful condition. Average rape in South Africa, a very, very, very poor country, or you can say a very backward country, there were only 33,000 rapes which were registered. And in the US, it's 89,000 rapes. So you call that advancement? Advanced in crime, advanced in shootouts, advanced in all type of tortures. And this is what we are doing. And advancement means, in a very brutal sense, good weaponry holding country is an advanced country. If I have the power to kill, then I should be an asura. I should not be a devata. And asura doesn't mean strength. In today's world, a well-developed country means a country which is having nuclear bombs, which is having more of power to kill others. That's the definition of what modern West thing is. And of course, you see today's date, maximum amount of drugs. Maximum amount of drugs, addicts. Every nook and corner, there is a psychotherapist is required for those people in the US and other advanced countries. In India, we are not come to that worst stage, but it's in those countries, still abroad. In India also, you know, the scenario is changing. Bangalore, money making place. People run over there. If you see 2007, the rate of people, 2,430 people have committed suicide. The suicide rate is slowly increasing in our country also. All these things like violence, unemployment, murder, rapes, corruption, all things are slowly increasing, and slowly is our death rate is also increasing because of these type of mental stress. Slow killer, a very slow killer. So, where did we go wrong? What is the solution? Common people say, prayer meetings are a good solution. Have a candle march and have a nice prayer meeting. Is that over? Now let's go into the scriptural angle. Let's see the scriptural angle of how to solve this problem. or rather we understand the problem. You know who is a good mechanic? One who opens the car and he is able to find out where the problem is. It's not the difference between a mechanic and a good mechanic is, the minute he opens the bonnet, he is able to find out, oh sir, aapka ye kharab ho gaya hai. This is a specific part which is spoiled, and he repairs. The difference between a good doctor and a doctor is one who is able to identify the disease in a minute. It's not that a bad doctor doesn't know the medical science, he knows, but he's not able to identify where the problem lies in your body. Similarly, if we are human beings, we should know what are we supposed to, where is the problem is lying. That is intelligence, so that we can solve the problem immediately. So first and foremost, let's understand the difference between a human being and an animal. Basic question. First fundamental question, what is the difference between human beings and animals? So I think all learned people are sitting over here, so I would like to have some response from you all. What do you think the difference between a human being and an animal? By animals can't think? You put a grain of salt, you put a grain of sugar in front of an ant, it will go only to the sugar and not to the salt. Siberian birds come from all the way from Siberia to India without a GPRS system. But for us, from going from here to Santa Cruz, we need a GPRS system. So who is more intelligent? Animal is more intelligent or we are more intelligent? Simple. We think, you know, people generally say, you know, a dog can sniff out a thief. Can you and I sniff out a thief? So who is more intelligent? Dog is more intelligent. Now, as for the scriptures, it's a different understanding altogether. Scriptures clearly say four things common between human beings and animals. Eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. Four things common. We also eat, they also eat. Might be. We might eat in a night restaurant or a nice dining table. They may eat in the road or the jungle, but both eat. Sleeping. We may sleep in a nice AC bedroom. They may sleep somewhere in the jungle or on the road or somewhere. Mating. We produce children. They also produce children. And finally, if someone comes to hit me, I'm going to defend myself. I'm going to protect myself. And similarly, if I go and kick a dog, it's going to bite me to protect itself. So these things, four things common. Ahar, Nidra, Bhay, Maithun. Four things common between human beings and animals. Then what makes us different? If these four things are there, we are a very nice two-legged animal. Dharmaheen manushya pashubhin saman. A person who doesn't have dharma is equal to an animal. Have you ever seen animals building a temple, reading Vedas, reading Bhagavad Gita, doing pujas? They are busy in these four things: eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. They are not interested in anything else more than that. If a lion gets up in the morning, in fact, it's better. No, they don't have the headache of going to the office or going to the school, putting the child to the classes, tuition classes, and all those things. It's much better. If dharma is minused from our life. Dharma vihin manushya pashu bin saman. Without dharma, a person is equal to an animal. That is the only one qualification which makes you into a human being. Otherwise, you are a very good, sophisticated, dvipadiya pashu, two-legged animal. Dharma should be there. If dharma is not there, it's of no use. It's a nice story. I'll be telling a lot of stories, don't worry. Once, Alexander the Great, he was having a camp, and in the night, when he was sleeping, a small thief entered. And somehow he managed to steal something. And he was going out, luckily he was, or his bad luck, he was caught. And brought before Alexander. Alexander asked him, "You're stealing in my camp?" "My camp, Alexander the Great's camp." "Yes, I was stealing." "Execute him." He simply told him to execute him. He said, wait, you can't execute me." He said, "Why?" "Hey, we both are in the same profession, how can you execute us?" He said, "How you are saying that? I am Alexander the Great and you are calling me and a thief and similar category?" "Yes, you plunder in a big way, I steal in a small way, but we both are plundering." So, if we don't have dharma, we are high class animals, sophisticated animals. We should have dharma. Otherwise, only difference is they are four-legged and we are two-legged. That's all. Let's not be animals. Let's now first come down to the level of human being. You know why, you know, this whole question of why, Prabhuji, why are you calling us for stress management and telling us whether we are human beings or animals? You know, that will be the question which you all will be asking. Animals don't commit suicide. Have you ever seen a horse going and committing suicide? Or a crow committing suicide? But we are committing suicides. That's a tragedy. So first we have to understand that we are not animals, we are human beings. That we have got something higher, a higher goal to be achieved. And higher intelligence has been given to us. If we are not using that intelligence, mind you, it's better to be an animal. We have to use our thing for dharma and something superior. A goal has to be achieved. Then what are we? According to the scriptures, then what are we? If we are not animals, we are just human beings. Scriptures have got a different definition altogether. We are basically soul. The existence of a soul inside a body is the proof of a human being. Now let's have the knowledge of the soul. Second chapter of Bhagavad Gita clearly talks about the soul. How the soul is, what is the size of the soul, what is the behavior of the soul, how inconceivable the soul is. Don't worry, it's stress management only. But let's go to the root problem of it. Let's not be worried, oh, I've been called for stress management, I've been talking to people, are talking to me about soul. But first, let's understand from the basics where we are and where we go. Okay, so just relax. Don't be stressed from a stress management class. Okay, so now the thing is, the soul cannot be cut. No, nainam chindanti shasani, nainam dahati pavaka, the famous sloka which you must have read many of times. So the soul cannot be cut, it cannot be melted, it cannot be dried, it cannot be wetted. The soul has got a lot of properties. This soul is the presence in the body. Now you will tell me now, Prabhuji, how can you say that I am a soul, I am not a body? This is quite an illogical topic you are talking about. So first I would like to ask you, what would you say? This is my hand, or you would call it, I am the hand? You would say, this is my hand, this is my leg, this is my head. I am not, I am the head. I don't say I am the head, I don't say I am the leg, I don't say I am the hand. I am saying this is my leg. Means what? It is possessed or belongs to me. It's like, this is my chair, this is my laptop. It is, I am not the laptop, this laptop is mine, it is belonging to me. So you have to understand, when we actually, what we are saying is, we are not realizing what we are saying. We are saying that this is my laptop. Means what? I am not the laptop. This laptop belongs to me. Like, this is my hair. Where do you see my hair? Am I saying this is, I am the hair? No, I don't say I am the hair. I am not saying I am the nose. This is my nose, my ears, my eyes. So you have to understand that these are things possessed by me. Then who is possessing this? The possessor is the soul. The soul is the possessor of the entire body. It's the difference is like a car and a driver. A car cannot budge a single inch without the driver. The driver is a living force which is making the car move. Simple. Now my name is Ram Kumar. Now you can see me moving, dancing, walking around. Suppose tomorrow I am dead and my body is lying here. That time why do you say, that is Ram Kumar's body? If someone were, some common person comes and says, oh, that's Ram Kumar sleeping. No, no, Ram Kumar has passed away. That is his body. That time only the realization of body and soul comes to our mind. Till then we never have a realization there is a soul existing in the body. Wo to chala gaya. Are wo kahan chala gaya? Wo to idhar hi hai. That time when the soul, if the body is lying in front of you, that time you realize, no, wo to body hi hai. Body ko jalane wala hai. Wo kahan hai? Wo to chala gaya. Kahan chala gaya? Kaun chala gaya? That is the difference. That time we realize, oh, this is the body of Mr. So-and-so and the soul of Mr. So-and-so has passed away. This is the main difference between a Vedic and a gross material science distinguishing. Gross material science does not talk about soul, but Vedic concepts go on the basis of soul, and which we and you, all of us, are talking day to day, but don't realize it. Till then, you don't realize it. The soul is present. That is why the body is having life. Once the soul is gone, why the body isn't moving? Why the body isn't walking? Why isn't he talking? If rest, everything was his body, everything was life, then why suddenly what has happened? No, the heart has stopped pumping. Why heart has stopped pumping? Okay, we pump his heart, then he should start walking, he should talking, he should do everything. Why he is not able to do that? So this is the basic concept is, and Bhagavad Gita has got a very nice concept on this. Lord says, this is like a covering on our body. No, this body is a covering. The soul is inside the body. And what physically what we are having is a covering. It keeps on changing. And you know, what was the size of the soul? Do you have any idea? Does anybody have an idea of the size of the soul? How big the soul must be? It's the tip of the hair. You just take the tip of the hair and cut it into 10,000 parts. That is the size of the soul. That is why a soul can be present even in a virus, a bacteria, and the smallest of the smallest living beings. If the size of the soul was as big as me, mind you, it would not fit. I would rather fit only in an elephant's body. The size of the soul is too small. But mind you, it's so powerful. Even an elephant is having the same size of the soul as that of an ant or a microscopic being. Same size of the soul. This is the size of the soul. It's quite astonishing. But it's mentioned in the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita. It clearly mentions about that. It's too small. Now people will say, I can't see the soul, so I can't see, I can't believe. You know, seeing is believing is a big concept in modern day life. I can't see the soul, so I can't sing. So I would rather say, if I add poison in a cup of coffee, you can't see the poison, so the poison doesn't exist. The poison exists that time also. Since you don't have the eyes to see that doesn't mean, why we don't have the eyes even to see an X-ray screen? Unless and until we are educated in a radiology or in a doctor, we can't even see an X-ray film. If I show an X-ray film to you, can you see the fracture in it? Whereas a doctor can see it. We are not able to see because we are not trained to see the eyes. The eyes are not trained to see. Similarly, in sugarcane, if I show you a sugarcane, I say, sugar is present in this. A foolish person will say, yes, I can't see the sugar, so sugar is not present. But a person who is educated, who has got knowledge, yes, from this sugarcane juice comes out and from that sugar is made. So he can derive the knowledge. Similarly, from the consciousness of a person's body, his movement, his all his lively activities, we come to know that, yes, there is the presence of a soul. This soul is the driving force of the body. If the soul is not there, the body would not move. The same thing applies for n number of things, you know. Like fire is there in the wood. If the fire would have not been there, the wood would have been, never be burning. The wood has having fire. Once you put it in the fire, that fire factor catches up. That's, you know, like if I tell you, there's oil in seeds, like groundnut, we have got oil. If you see the groundnut, you can't see any oil. Whereas when you crush it, when you take the oil out of it, that time the oil comes. So things is present. We don't have the eyes to see it properly. Second chapter, Lord very clearly says, Deyino asman yatha dehe kaumaram yovanam jara tad dehantara prapti diras satrana muyati. See, the embodied body soul continues to pass from one body to another. This is what happens at the time of death. A point which all of us are afraid to talk about. But it's a core fact. At the time of death, our body changes, is left behind, and the soul takes up a new body. A new body is taken up, and there are stages, child, youthhood, old age, and then finally death. So this is a cycle which is going on and on and on. So it's not that thing, and Lord clearly says, Vasamsi jirana yathavaya navani granati naro prani tat sharanena vithaya jiyaya anyani samyati navani dehi. In 2.22, Lord clearly says, as the garment becomes old, what we do with an old dress of ours? We throw it and we take up a new dress. Similarly, the body grows old. And this has been, we have been watching this right from childhood. We have been seeing old, a person going old, leaving his body, and then we feel, oh, that's the end of it. No, the soul has gone away. Mr. Your grandfather, he has passed away. Where did he pass off? His body is here. No, he has passed off. Means what? He has taken up another body. And then he is taking up a new life. And the cycle is going on again and again and again and again. So, coming back to the stress management part. Okay, now you must be wondering, Prabhuji, you have deviated a lot from the stress management part. Today is stress management. Don't worry, this is like a serial movie, you know. A part of the story is shown and then the linkage is given. Why this part I explained to you, I'll come back to you at later part of this session. Now, stress management is coming, the stress point of view is working today is physical working for 18 to 20 hours. We are all working right from morning 5 o'clock. We slog, prepare a dabba, run to the office, work for the company and then coming back, evening looking after the family. Common problem. Mental stress, performance, targets, become a part of everyone's life. And the worst part is, this stress is being systematically being passed down to the children. Children are not supposed to have the stress. But our stress is pumped into them some way or the other. This is the main crude cause of children also coming into the, you know, getting tuned to stressful life. And then, now you hear children, I mean, when we were also kids, we used to never have a suicide rate for children. But today, suicide rate for children is also going very high. Why? What's so wrong? They don't have to go to office, they don't have to earn, they don't have to run the family. They don't have any responsibilities to be done, but still, performance has become a big stress management to them. Now, Shastras identify problems in two ways. One is relative problem and one is real problems. Now, what are relative problems? Common problems. Children not studying. Most of the parents must be facing this problem. My child doesn't study well. Solution to the classes. It is a problem to you, but it's a solution to the classes. Your AC is too hot, and the AC is not working. Good. It's a solution to the mechanic. You are falling sick. Every doctor in Nanga, I don't know if there are any doctors over here, by the way. But in one session, we had a doctor in our session. He said, what do you used to do in the morning? I pray, God, send me some sick people today. Every doctor prays in the morning. Every mechanic, you know, he does agarbatti to his garage and says, Bhagavan, do char gaadi todi dena, aaj mere paas bheji dena. So what we actually face problems is actually a solution to somebody else. If you don't fall sick, what will happen to the doctors? If your car doesn't break down, what will happen to the car mechanics? If your child started studying very well, what will happen to all the classes? What will they do? So it's a simple thing. You know, your gadget, your mobile is cocking off, your mobile is getting hanged up. What is the use? If it doesn't get hanged up, what will be all the mechanics who are opened up shops, what will they do? So these are basically not problems. But the problem is, we take them as the stress. These are not the real problems, but we take these problems as real problems and we are stressed about it. But the real problems, what Shastra says, that's really the most important part of the session. Common to all. Nobody wants it, but everybody gets it. And we are not worried about this real problem. Now, what are these real problems? As per scriptures, there are only three main problems: Adidevik, Adibhautik, and Adhyatmik. Adidevik problem is caused by nature, Adibhautik is caused by other living entities, and Adhyatmik problem is by his own mental problems. And lastly, birth, death, old age, and disease. Major four problems. Now we will discuss on this slide for around 5 minutes. It's a very important slide. Most important to understand what the real problem is and how we are wasting our intelligence, time and energy in understanding relative problems which are not a problem. They are not at all a problem. Your problem is a solution to somebody else, as I told you earlier. But this is not a solution to somebody. Your birth, your death, your old age and your diseases are not solution to others. They are a big problem for you on the root cause. Those have a solution. Your AC is spoiled, you can buy a new AC. Your car is gone, you can buy a new car. But what can you do with disease, with old age, with birth and then death? Can you say, no, I don't want to die? No chance. Now, why these, what are these Adi Devik, Adi Bhautik and Adhyatmik? Let's just discuss about this in detail. Adi Devik, common problems what we see, floods, famines, you know, all this type of natural disasters which are not in human control. They are going to happen, they will happen, and these are, you have to undergo these problems. This is by default in this earth, everyone faces this. Adi Bhautik, a very common problem. Boss is a problem, sometimes wife is a problem, sometimes husband is a problem, if children are a problem, and if not, a mosquito can make problem in your life. Everybody is troubled by some other human being or the other. And this is mentioned in the scripture. It's not something which is invented over here. It's mentioned in the scriptures. And Adhyatmik, always stressed, what will happen to my child, which college he will go, which line he will take, whether he will be, these problems always, you know, these worries, mental worries and mental problems are always there. And now how can I say birth is a problem? Can anybody put some light on this matter? Birth is a problem. Shastra say, Bhagavatam clearly talks about birth as a problem. 9 months you are put in a bag, upside down, and a bag containing urine, stool, pus and blood. And you are upside down and in a crunched up position. You think it's a very nice place to stay? Enjoyable place. Whatever the mother eats, the child has to eat. If mother is not well, the child has to suffer. And you, millions of births, we all have undergone this. It's not something new. Shastras talk about this as a real problem. Birth, death. What happens at the time of death? Your car is in your garage. Your money is in the bank. Your gold is in the locker. Maximum your husband, wife, your children may just cry for a couple of days. Many times I have seen nowadays the fight starts in the night itself over the property before the body is burnt, or just the body is burnt and they come back and the fight starts. And what is there? Everything is a big zero. Whatever you have earned, whatever you have slogged your entire life to make a big capital for the house, all that becomes a big zero because you cannot carry anything along with you. That's a tragedy. Even I think Ambani, when he died, he could not carry any money along with him. He had to leave back everything. So this death is a very big factor. After that, old age, the most dangerous thing, insecurity just cramps up when you're old. You don't know what is going to happen. You don't have anybody to take care. You're too old to take care of yourself. You don't know whether the money what you have earned and kept is enough for yourself. And at that time, disease sure to crop up, sure to crop up. And these diseases have really, they are really, you are troubled to the core. Tell me which disease is nice. Do you have any disease? Do you know any disease which is very pleasing or nice feeling you will have when you have a disease? God forbidden, but even if you go to Tata Memorial Hospital, go to cancer hospitals, see what the tragedy, what they under. Disease is really horrible. Many diseases kills you, kills your family members, kills the entire family. By the time you are treated, in the hope of getting treated, they spend money behind you, and finally you are not treated, you die, and the whole money what the family had, even that is lost. These are the actual problems. Shastra says we are goofing around problems which are not relevant or not, which are not, which are relative, which have got solutions somewhere or the other, or which are not permanent. You know, when I was, with my wife, when we used to have, when our kid was small, hey, bacha kab bada hoga yaar? I don't have to clean the potty. I don't have to do those things. You know, the child would do everything. The child grew big. That problem was solved, but then education became a problem. When the child grew strong, now of course my daughter's in college, so it's a new set of problems. Okay, my child, school, dropping the child to the school, picking it up, those problems solved. So these are changing problems. These problems don't stay permanently at that point. They change. Whereas these will not change. Right from Ambani to a beggar, everyone has to face these problems. No one is saved from these problems. And if you are able to solve this problem, it's a big thing. No science has advanced to solve these four problems. What science gives is only temporary patchwork, temporary solutions. Now, for example, old age, no problem. Lot of age miracle creams are now available. You got lost your teeth, no problem. You got a denture to make. We can make a given fit a denture to your mouth. You got a pain, you got painkillers. But it's not a solution, it's a patchwork. 4 hours, 5 hours. Once the medicine loses its potency, you're back in your pain. Is this a solution? And how long? There's a very nice joke. An old lady was there. Sorry, a young lady was there, moving around. And one fellow was watching. He wants, nowadays, staring. Stalking the lady. See, she went inside. She started undressing herself. First removed her wig and kept it on the table. She removed her denture and kept it out. Removed her contact lenses. Removed her makeup. Then what he saw was very quite horrifying. So this is what science gives. No doubt. Apparently, a person may look pleasing. But you cannot cover up the real problem of old age. Wrinkles can be covered, cannot be removed. It can be covered, but it can't be removed. So this is what is the problem. Now, I will not discuss much about this because you all are much aware. I mean, you all are more educated in this matter than me, I can say. What are the side effects of stress? So many diseases like stomachache, heart diseases, cold, flu, skin disease, skin problems, stomach ulcers, and number of problems. So now we go to the escape formula. Prabhuji, you have told a lot of the problems. We are already stressed out. You are giving us more stress by giving us more problems. Now let's talk about the solutions for the problems. Let's start the journey for solutions. This escape formula is very simple. E, give up unreasonable expectations. S stands, go for the substance, not for the package. C, give up unhealthy competitions. A, appreciate God's blessings upon you. P, be patient, neglect worldly passion and opinion. And E, endeavor difficulties through faith. Giving up unreasonable expectations. Imaginary expectations and actual facts are two different things. Let's understand this fact very nicely. We expect our child to study whatever the study material has been given, the child is going to absorb. That is our expectation. That is not the reality. But the reality may be two children may be studying the same book. Each child has got a different level of absorption. Our expectation doesn't increase the absorption level of the child. No. We may expect, my child should learn the table up to 18th level or the 20th table when he's in first standard or in second standard. Your expectation need not be to the level of the absorption of the child. We expect the child to do so many things. Many parents I've seen, they expect the child right from morning to night. Oh, you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that. No, without an expectation, false expectation is very bad. This applies to our elderly people also. It's a nice story over here. Once a donkey was working for a washerman. So he was working for that washerman, working very hard, laboriously he is working right from morning to night. So the other donkey friend he had, he was not working, he used to relax. He told him, why are you working like a real donkey, man? You are a real donkey. You are working like a donkey from morning to night. Look at me, I am so relaxed, I enjoy the whole day. The end of the day, what you are getting? Little grass. That is freely available around the riverside. Why you want to work? He said, "Arey, tu gada ka gada rahega. I am a very intelligent person." I said, "Why?" "Arey, last week my boss was shouting at his daughter. He was telling her, see, tu aise karti rahegi na, to is gade ke saath teri shaadi kara dunga." So this fellow is in the expectation that one day the washerman is going to put his daughter to him, give his daughter to him. But this is a fact. This is what the companies give us, a carrot. An unrealistic carrot is given to us. One day you're going to be the CEO of the company. कंपनी में है क्या 50 CEOs रहेगा? एवरीवन इन द कंपनी इज गिवन अ कैरेट, ओके यू आर गोइंग टू बी द नेक्स्ट मैनेजर ऑफ दिस यू नो जोनल एरिया हेड और रीजनल हेड एंड ब्ला 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 एंड दैट कैरेट मेक्स यू वर्क लाइक अ डोंकी. लेट्स हैव रियलिस्टिक एक्सपेक्टेशन. दिस विल रिड्यूस योर स्ट्रेस. व्हाई यू आर हैविंग अनरियलिस्टिक एक्सपेक्टेशन? दिस अप्लाइज टू आवरसेल्व्स. एट द सेम टाइम दिस अप्लाइज फॉर द चिल्ड्रन ऑल्सो. Let's not have unrealistic expectation. Oh, my son, oh, he is born Milka Singh. He is going to win the race. No. Please. However, you may feed him the best of the kaju, badam, almonds, everything. He is going to be your child, first and foremost. Let's not have an expectation that he is going to run like Milka Singh. No. So let's have expectations which are more realistic. Let's not have a larger in life expectation. This leads to a wide gap, which leads to stress, and finally children fall into the fear trap. Oh, my father, my mother is expecting so much from me, my father is expecting so much from me, then what do I do? That's where the children go to the tendency, get the tendency of suicide and all that stuff, because our expectations are too high and children are not able to provide the necessary expectation. This is where it starts. Success, you know, very nice word which everyone wants, but we don't know how to achieve it. Success is not a trophy to be won, but it's a race to be run. Tell me, 2014, how many children came top? Can you remember their names who came top in SSC? In 2012, 2013, 2014, 2015, let's say two children, three children from all boards came up with top ranking thing. Where are they today? Are they sounding anywhere? Success, people take it as a momentary thing. It's something which has to be run. It is not to be won. Success is something to be given, not to be taken. Success is something which you have to achieve and keep it for a longer time. It's not something like, okay, I want my child to be first in the class. Tell me, from first standard to ninth standard, the child studies, slogs, comes first. You mean to say, in SSC, every child from every school who has worked, slogged and come first is going to be the topper of the university or the board? For what are we making the child slog? Let the child be given some leverage of enjoyment in the childhood. Let him play, let him live his own life. Squeezing him, okay, the whole life is left for him to run. He has to run. Up to the grave, he has to run. He or she, it may be, today there's no difference. But we are asking our children, no. Right from the mother's womb, we are asking the child, come on, run. What for? Let the child be given some room. Get the child be given some space. Let the child's education stress or expectations be increased gradually. From the class 1, KG, sub-junior KG, it might be playgroup, the parents want their child to be one. First. I was shocked to see once, he had a small game session in Goregaon. Riscon had arranged a mela. And we had a small game called, Finding the Putna game was there. So it was like, four or five faces were kept, blank faces were kept. And the child had to identify, okay, go and stand in this line. And there is Putna and you get a small prize. And the prize was nothing, mind you, a small sticker. A small sticker, that's it. Mind you, the parents are speculating. Beta, tu wo line mein khada rehna, ye line mein khada rehna. उसको गेम भी उसके लिए ही इज नॉट एबल टू प्ले ऑफ हिज फ्री विल. इवन द गेम ऑल्सो द चाइल्ड इज बीइंग डायरेक्टेड बाय द पेरेंट्स. बच्चा ये लाइन में, नहीं नहीं ये लाइन में, नहीं नहीं ये लाइन में. अरे इज ही गोइंग टू, व्हाट इज ही गोइंग टू गेट? एम ट्रॉफी और समथिंग? स्मॉल गेम. द गेम इज मेंट फॉर द रिलैक्सेशन ऑफ द चाइल्ड, बट दैट हैज बीन मेड इनटू अ स्ट्रेसफुल मोमेंट फॉर द चाइल्ड. माय मदर इज स्टैंडिंग, माय फादर इज स्टैंडिंग, आई एम सपोज टू विन. इफ आई एम नॉट विनिंग, आई एम नॉट रेसिंग. इफ आई विन, आई व्हाट आई गेट? आई गेट अ डोमिनोज पिज्जा इन द एंड. as well you can buy that for the child anyhow. You don't have to make the child run. The same carrot joke. The same, your boss gives you a carrot, I am going to make you the next year you will be the zonal manager. And you work this whole year, you would work like a donkey. Then next year, sorry, year, not this year, next year you are guaranteed you are going to be the zonal manager. Same things. Systematically, we are passing on the same thing to the child. Come on, play, you win, I'll give you a Domino's pizza. Khelne do, let him relax. Let him play, let him be relaxed. No. This is a practical, this is not something which I'm talking about, it's something which has happened in front of me. I was shocked to see this. Substance and content. This is a very important thing. Let's have a small experiment for this. As you can see, I know many people can't see, I'll show it to you. A plastic glass, I just spilled some water in it. A steel glass, filled the same water from the same bottle, not a different bottle. Silver glass, very nice silver glass, a costly glass. And I filled the same water in this also. No difference. So let me taste the water from the plastic glass. Quenching my thirst, because I'm thirsty, talking for a long time. Let me see the difference in the steel glass. When this is tasting the same, quenching my thirst. My most favorite silver glass. Ah, this also quenches my thirst. Now, the problem is, we people are not worried about the content of it. We are interested in the packaging of it. This is one of the root cause of the problem. Mind you, everything is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. I am not talking anything outside Bhagavad Gita. Now, I am not mentioning any shlokas because right now, if my talking of shlokas will not make any sense to you all. Because you are not conversant with it, so I am not talking about the shlokas. But this is the difference. Water in the plastic glass was also the same, quenched my thirst. The steel glass also quenched my thirst. And the silver glass also quenched my thirst. But if given a choice, what would we do? Gun for the silver glass, not for the plastic glass or for the steel glass. Simple. What we are having, we are not content with that. We want something more. We are not worried about the content. A simple, a mobile phone. Let's say, you want to buy a mobile phone. What is the purpose of a mobile phone? Incoming, outgoing, well, nowadays WhatsApp is of course an integral part of our life, no? Without WhatsApp, we can't survive nowadays. Internet and GPRS is also an internet part of it. But other than that, what is the difference if I go for a 75,000, 80,000 mobile and for a 10, 12,000 rupees mobile? What's the difference? As long as it is serving your purpose. Your purpose is basic functions of the mobile served. But we see, it's not that I'm trying to determine any brand or anything of the sort. Without naming any brand, I'm talking about this. The cost of the product does not affect the performance of the product. The performance of water in this silver glass is the same performance as that in the glass of plastic. It was quenching my thirst. It's not that by drinking in a plastic glass, my thirst is increasing more. Or by drinking in a silver glass, the thirst is being quenched immediately. No. It's equal at all levels. It is our perception, our thinking. If I buy a 5,000 rupee dress, I'll look more beautiful, I'll look like a model. And if I buy a 1,000 rupee dress, no, I'll look ugly. It's simple. A dress is a dress. If it is stitched, if it is made properly, if it is covering your body, and if it is making you look presentable, if you are presentable, you will look presentable in any dress. It's necessary you have to go for a 10,000 rupee dress. No, I am having a small Ritz car, I am having a small Maruti car, I want to have a BMW. Slog for it. Simple. And you know, I don't know how much time will you require to come to that level. You have to go on working very nicely. The content is always forgotten. The content is left aside. And we are analyzing at what level we are taking up the stress for what? You want to earn money for water, or you want to earn money for a silver glass containing water? This has to be analyzed. Silver glass is an option, not a compulsion. Water is a compulsion. So let's go to the glass of water which is quenching our thirst, rather than running behind trying to earn hard for the silver glass. Finally, even that is going to quench your thirst. Even if you have anything, you know, things can't give you happiness. Things don't really can't give you happiness. Just imagine you are sitting in a nice restaurant. Nice restaurant, you know, evening, having a nice candlelight dinner, nice sizzlers and nice stuffings, perfectly blended stuffings, perfectly blended taste. As per your requirement, you are having a nice food. And suddenly from your office pops in. Hey, you know, you just lost your job, you know, your boss has fired you. It's the same restaurant, the same AC, the same food in front of you. Will it taste the same? Will it taste the same? Things, happiness is not in the thing. Happiness doesn't lie in that sizzler. It may only fill your belly. And mind you, next day morning it's going to go out in you. However best you may have to eat it. You can't retain it in your body. So let's not have too high an expectations. For what are we having these expectations in that bargain? We are just taking up stress. You know, in today's world, there is a nice thing. People are supposed to be loved and things are supposed to be used. But we do the opposite. We are loving the gadgets. We are loving the things and we are using relations and people. This is what is today's world. It has become exactly the reverse. See, we generally say, I'm stressed up, I'm fed up, I'm working, slogging. We have invited these problems. These problems did not exist. They are not existing. We have invited them. What is the thing, what are the things which give you happiness? Now, let's say you have a very nice, you purchase a very nice limousine car, stretch limousine car, sitting inside it. Or rather, you just bought a car and you parked it in your garage and someone calls you up and tells you, your very close one has expired. Or you suddenly come to know that your children are not well, not keeping well, they are unhealthy. Just got a news that someone has contacted some very dirty disease. Now what would you do? Immediately run and sit in that side of that car? You will feel happy? Right. Things are supposed to give you happiness, right? Immediately go to the shop and buy an iPhone. It will make you happy. The minute you get a sad news, you run to the shop, buy an iPhone, I'm happy. Is it going to be? That's the problem. We are still happy with gadgets and things. And relations, no problem. They are sour, no problem. I have a divorce case pending, no problem. I am interested in my gadget. The people are in today's life are running in this reverse manner. They are not running in the productive manner, but in the reverse manner they are running. Things are more important. Gadgets are more important. Cars, flats. I have got one flat. No, I want one more flat. But you will have to go and you will be shifted to another city. You'll have to stay separate from your family. No problem. I'll stay separate from my family. because more important is my car or my flat rather than my family. At the time of old age, the family is going to be taking care of you, not about this car. But you know what has happened? This has systematically killed our culture in the children. This has, you know, our money-mindedness has gone in the blood of the children. And what has happened is, the end result is, in 20 years, you know, last 25, 30 years, what I am noticing, old age homes have increased. Children aren't bothered about taking care of the parents. Because we have injected them that vitamin M injection inside them. And they are now interested in taking care of their own self at their young age and rather keeping the parents in old age homes rather not keeping care of them. When you at your young age are busy earning behind money and not sparing some time for the child, why would the child at his young age be bothered about your old age? It's a clear equation. It's not wrong. We have created a wrong equation. If a child writes a wrong answer, how can you expect the teacher to give marks? It's like that. This equation itself has been taught wrongly. You run behind money. Beta, you don't worry about us. Fine. Then when you're in the last stages of your life, no, nobody's there to take care of me. I think I have to go to some old age home and get myself admitted over there. You have dug your grave. We in Vedic culture told me, tell me during the Vedic time, how many old age homes were there in India? Or rather than that time, how many parents were left out of the house? Great-great-grandparents were there, they were taken care of. Everything systematically has been killed by the British. You know, if you go and search in the Google Baba will give you a nice, you can search in the Google and you will get a nice thing. The first viceroy who came and visited India, he has written a letter back to the Queen, back in England. And he said, I have never seen a country like this, so rich in culture. If we have to rule, and then this country doesn't have any beggars. Mind you, this was the word used in that thing. It's there in the Google. It's not that I'm just concocting and telling this. It's mentioned in the Google, the internet. It says clearly, there is no beggar in this country. It's an amazing country. If we have to rule this country, we will have to break the cultural background of this country. This is what they have done in systematically when they were ruling us. They broke our cultural background. They have told us, you know, very systematic, what they have done. Today you go and ask a child, Harry Potter is true. Hanuman is wrong. Superman is correct. Hanuman is wrong. Hanuman is mythology. Bhagavad Gita, Mahabharata, Ramayana is mythology. Harry Potter is true. Whatever junk given by them is true. But they had to do it. It's not that it's like they had to make us slaves. When you would become slave, when you accept them as something superior. And they had to prove that their education system was much better. They were having better science, scientific knowledge. What we are talking of sonography today, in today's date, what we can see, you know, hear or see the child's movement in the mother's womb. Bhagavatam talks 5,000 years before about these things. How a 9-whole lump is formed in the womb of the mother first. It has been mentioned 5,000 years before, not today. It's a tragedy that today we are finding and reading science and finding out, oh, it's a great invention, sonography machine, we can find out the child's movement. What about the child's movement? It is written about what the child thinks in the mother's womb also. This is the advancement of our Vedic textures. Scriptures are giving that much of knowledge. What the child thinks, forget about the movement of the child. What is happening? Everything is mentioned. Okay, I will not take your time on that. But the thing is, those things are in the depth of the knowledge is given in the scriptures. But the tragedy is, we are busy in our own world, in our own comparison of things. So let's not compare things. You know, this is one thing which have to be kept out, you know. Let's not be gadget conscious. Let us be human conscious. Let us be human friendly. What happens, you know, I've seen many people in the train also. Arey, iske haath mein iPhone hai. Iske haath mein MI phone hai. Hone de na. Uske haath mein hone se, is he going to be having four hands? Or is he going to fly? Woh bhi wohi dhakka kha raha hai jo tum kha raha hai. Then what's the difference? If I am buying an iPhone, am I going to be lifted inside the railway train? No, I have to be kicked anyway. So it doesn't make any difference. Anyway, it needs to remain the same. But people have got that idea. No, by this, I'll be happy. I'll be in a very happy state. Sorry. If a bad news has to come, be it be an iPhone, it is going to give you a bad news only. It's not going to give you a good news. Vice versa, if it is a good news, if it's because it's a cheaper mobile, it's not going to become a bad news. It's going to be the same thing. That samne wala jo bolne wala, wahi sunne wala hai. You know, it's not going to, words are not going to change with respect to the value of the money. Unhealthy competition. One has to give up unhealthy competition. Very important. You know, we compare. Very easily we compare. Beta, you have got 80%. Your friend has got 85%. Tujhe bhi main wahi school mein bhejta hu. Tujhe bhi main wahi classes mein bhejta hu. I send you to a better classes. And you know, I buy you know, all better notes for you. Or rather, stationery stuff for you. You know, everything I give better for you. But you got 5% less than your friend. How come? Same child reversely ask you a question. Father, my friend's father is having a BMW car. You are having only a Maruti car. Why? What answer do you have for that? Just because the child doesn't reverse the question and puts it back to you, you are in a driver's seat, and if he talks, hey chop marega. That's all the maximum you can say. But the fact lies, why would you like to compare two children? Each child is an individuality of its own. He has got his own propensities of doing things the right way and the good way. Why should it be compared? What's the big deal? Each child is unique by its own. The child is unique. But no, we will compare the two children. If the child says, Mom, my friend's mom is looking so beautiful. You're looking like a fat, ugly duckling. No, what if it's the reverse, he talks to you, how you would feel? That is not acceptable. I can compare, but you don't compare me. That is always, you know, we like to compare, but we don't like to be compared. We should never be compared. Dad, you're earning only 50,000 rupees a month. My friend's father is earning 70,000 rupees a month. Why? What's so bad about you? You didn't study well. Simple. If this question is reversely asked, then what would be its value? Do you stand? But we very easily bump this question to the child. Oh, many people I have seen many times when my children were small, thrashing in the school itself. Not even going home and thrashing, they were thrashing the child in the school itself. Arre, you got only 75, you got 80. Arre, pass ho gaya na, bas ho gaya na. If you first aayega, tobhi SSC board is not going to recognize that. Or ICIC board is not going to, in 10th what he gets, that's the percentage is going to be reflecting in the mark sheet. You all throughout from KG to 9th standard, whatever percentage he gets, it is not going to reflect in the mark sheet in the SSC. So why are you thrashing the child right now? Thousand meters race, you know, it's a 5-lap, 7-lap race is there. People generally start running the race. And the first person who starts running in the first lap itself, you see, he never is a winner. He's the last always. This is a common thing you can note, but still, no. From KG, my child should run first. What is the funda? I don't understand. A child is running, you know, a person who starts running the 1,000, you know, 10 lap, 8 lap or 7 lap, I don't know, I'm not a good sportsman, okay. But 8 lap or 10 lap, the first 2 laps, the person who is ahead is always a loser. Whereas the last 5 laps, a person who picks up a speed and wins very systematically, and he maintains his energy, you know, reserves his energy, and then he uses it in the last 3 laps and he wins. So why don't you reserve the child's energy like that? Instead of just making him run like a donkey. Okay, there is enough. Let him enjoy some life. Most important thing, appreciate the blessings given to you by Lord. We always have got a tendency to crib of what we are not having. But we have never appreciated of what we are having. This is a very common problem in generally we see. You know, if you don't have experience, danger of war, loneliness of prison and hunger, you're better than 500 million people of this world. You know that? 500 million people are just suffering from loneliness of prison, war and danger of war and hunger. Your basic needs are met. Basic needs are met. You're richer than 75% of the population of this world. Even if you have something, you are a part of the 10% of the prosperous people in this world. If you have someone whose hand you can hold or you can hug somebody, you know, in your bad moments, in your sad moments, you have a shoulder to cry on, be happy. So many people are lonely in this world. Just if you can read this, be blessed. Mind you, 2 million people in this planet cannot see. Be happy. At least you have got an eyesight to read this, you can see this. Better than the 2 million people in this world who cannot see. We always crave for things which we are not having rather than being happy of what we are having. We always count our problems and we are always miserable. We're never happy of what we have. But it is said, one who is not grateful is a great fool. You know, many times I've seen parents cribbing at the child. Come on, why are you not studying? Come on, study properly. You know, it's better not to have a child. A foolish child like you. I would be childless. I've seen parents looking at this. Have you ever gone and seen the pangs of a couple who doesn't have a child? Ever seen the torture what they undergo? How much they die for a couple dies for have a child? Be grateful that you are having a child, a normal child, not a physically or a mentally handicapped child. Have you ever thanked yourself for that? You are richer than the richest, mind you. I know big top business people who don't have children. You may be a very small person, even a small worker in a small company, but still you are richer than that rich man. You are having a healthy child. There are so many people who don't have life partners. You are having a life partner, you are having a child. Okay, you have, my mother-in-law is horrible. Okay, fine. Be happy having a mother-in-law. Why are you not happy by saying that? My mother-in-law is torturous, my father-in-law is torturous, my house is not good, this is not good. You are at least having a house. It may not be a four bedroom hall kitchen flat. It may be a one BHK, it may be one room, no problem. But at least you are having something, you are enjoying your life. Better than someone, you know, it's the old saying, you know, it goes, never crib, you know, I forgot, was taught in the school. See a person who doesn't have a leg rather than cribbing on the shoe which you don't have. At least be happy than that person who doesn't have a leg. You are at least better off than that person. But we are never satisfied with what we are. I am having an ordinary car. I want a better car. I am having a flat in, let's say in Andheri, I want to buy in Bandra. If I am having in Bandra, I want to buy in Ebensi Road. Whole life goes in working for that. Finally, you are not landing up in any situation, you in a solution, you are landing up in a bigger problem. Jumping from one problem to another problem, very systematically. And, you know, blaming God is a very easy question, you know. Bhagavan, maine itna mehnat kiya, tune mera madad nahi kiya. Common thing. Bhagavan, you don't exist. God, you don't exist. If you were existing, my problem would have been solved. As if God is sitting to solve your problems. Proof. What is the proof of a creator? You know, this is common questions which is asked by God, you know. Bhagavan dikhta nahi, iske liye God doesn't exist. I cannot see God. I can believe only what I can see. I will ask you one question. You have got intelligence? Show it to me. If you can't show me, you don't have God. You don't have intelligence. You have a mind? Can you show me your mind? You can't show me your mind. So you don't have a mind. There are things which are subtle. Forget about mind and missing. Can you show me air? You can't show me air. Sir, I can feel air. When I put the fan, the air comes and hits me. So you can feel air. That doesn't mean you cannot see air, means doesn't mean you cannot, there is no existence of air. You can feel air. Similarly, God has to be felt. If, for a simple example, this projector is there. When I see this projector, means there is a company which is manufacturing this project. That means what? There are workers working in the factory. Simple. That means there are some people working. It is an implied common sense. The company is manufacturing, the factory is manufacturing this. That means there are workers working in the factory who are making this projector. And that means it is owned also by somebody. Or the school is owning, or I am owning. Somebody is owning it. So the presence of a thing surely shows that there is an owner of it. This is a very nice joke. Once there was a debate, a fight, an argument between God and a scientist. And the scientist said, you know, God, what you can do, I can also do. I am as good as you. I said, oh, great. And God said, what can you do? See, I can make human being also very easily. Oh, okay, very good. Do. Show me. He started making. God said, stop. Why? अपना सामान लेके आके बना ना, मेरा सामान से क्यों बना रहे? Everything which is existing is possessed by somebody. Simple. If this building is there, the existence of this building means somebody is possessing this building. Similarly, this earth is present means it is possessed by somebody. This somebody is no one else than God. People have a general concept, oh, God, where is God? I can't see God, so there's no God. Fine, don't believe, no problem. God says, either you can realize me in the scriptures, or at the time of death, you will definitely meet me. Because Lord says in the 11th chapter, Kalo asmi, I am the Kal, I am the death-devouring death, all-devouring death, I am the all-devouring death. Everything is spoken in the Bhagavad Gita. Everything. You know, what is Bhagavad Gita? Basically, a user's manual. You know, when you buy a mobile, you get a user's manual. When you buy a washing machine, you get a user's manual. When you buy anything, even if you buy an LED TV also, you get a user's manual along with it. What is that? How to use it? Now, if I buy a washing machine, I know, I press any damn button, it's going to spoil the machine. Similarly, this user machine has to be, the book has to be studied. At least the basic concept has to be studied. Then you use the instrument. Same way, this has to be done. Human birth has been given. How to live this life is given in this Bhagavad Gita, the manual. That talks about how you have to live a life. A human life, as I told you, part one, animal and human being, what a difference. As a human life, how do you live that? That mentions that. So this is a very important thing. And what is definition of God? You know, there's another big problem. You know, nowadays, you know, people have got a flair of claiming themselves to be God. That's another fashion of the present trend. I am God. God has a definition. He is having a clear-cut, finite definition of six opulences in full. These opulences are to full. Dhanvan, Gyanvan, Rupvan, Vairagyavan, Aishwaryavan. These are all his opulences. These are to be full. It's not that one person, I may be rich. I may be Ambani. I may be one of the richest person in the world. I am not the all richest person. Whereas the Lord says he is Dhanvan. He is having the richness of the whole world. Balwan, one may be strong, you know, he may be Olympic winner. One may be a strong person. But he is not having all the strength of this world. So he is, the full opulence is there inside him. So the Vedic scriptures gives the entire definition of God. So I am not taking that depth of it. This is another important problem which generally people see. Be principled, don't be swayed away by worldly opinions. Let not others decide for you. Be content with what you have and what you buy. This is another problem which I generally see, especially in the working community. One friend, suppose you bought a Chevrolet car. Your friend comes and tells, "Hare, tune ye kyun kharida? You should have bought a BMW, or you should have bought a Maruti, or you should have bought this." Immediately, your brain starts moving. It's like an old story which we used to have in your school days. Father and son donkey story. Those morals stand true even till today. The father, son and a donkey were going through many villages. They were walking together. People started laughing. Arey, देखो बाप इतना बूढ़ा है बेटा जवान है, बाप को बिठाता नहीं है, बेटा को बेटा चल रहा है घोड़े को लेके, डोंकी को ऊपर बिठा के लेके जा सकता था. देन दे मेड द फादर सिट ऑन द डोंकी, दे वेंट टू द नेक्स्ट विलेज. द नेक्स्ट विलेज, सी लुक एट दिस ओल्ड फेलो, यंग बच्चे को चला रहा है, ओल्ड मैन इज सिटिंग. दे चेंज द प्लेसेस, वेयर द फादर वॉज केम डाउन, द सन वॉज सिटिंग ऑन द डोंकी. देन दे वर वॉकिंग, आफ्टर सम टाइम, ही वॉट अ फूल यार, लुक एट द सन इज सिटिंग एंड द ओल्ड फादर इज वॉकिंग. देन दे बोथ सैट ऑन द डोंकी and the donkey started moving. And then third, some animal lovers came and they said, oh, look at the donkey is being tortured. He should get down, both should get down. And they took the donkey on their shoulder and they started walking. So this is what is the story in day-to-day life. If you put a child in karate class, hey, you are not put him in badminton classes. You are not put him in music class. You are not put him in dancing class. Hey, Sare Gama Pa mein gaega, Dance India mein jaega. Have you asked the child, what is your interest? No. It is solely left to your interest or decision of the parent, not even the parent, the parent's friend. The parent's friend decides what is important for the parent, for the child. We don't understand the logic behind those implications behind things. Just blindly. One friend comes and gives you an advice, no, you put your child in dance class. Okay, put him in the dance class. Then someone, no, put him in skating class. Next Olympic skating mein jeetega ye. TK, put him in the skating class. What's this? I don't understand. We have to understand. We have to be principled. No, I'm going, like, my child has a liking for music. I'm going to send him to the music class. My child has a liking for, let's say, karate. I'm going to send him for the self-defense karate class. Let's be principled. Let's stick to our rudiments, our principles. We are diverting ourselves with respect to the opinions given by others. Let's not do that. Now, why should be this our story? This is a very common thing which I have seen. When I was a child, I was dying to go to college. When I was in college, I was dying to start earning. When I was earning, I was dying to get married. When I was married, I was dying to have kids. When I have had kids, I was dying to get them educated. And when they were educated, I was dying to get them married. Now I am dying. I realized I forgot to live. This is a common life problem with all of us. We forget to live our life in the whole race of creating up, you know. In the end, you know, this realization comes. Many people get in the early 50s, you know. Oh, abhi to mera bachche bade ho gaye and I didn't live a life. Yes, you definitely did not live a life. You could have lived a life, and in life in such a way, by gaining knowledge, not material knowledge. Mind you, material knowledge is not going to give the entire crux of the thing. We are just learning things in a routine manner. Rather than, if we have some knowledge of the Vedic knowledge, some Vedic knowledge, it would be better. But we are busy in our own life, running behind things and always hankering for something which you are going to get anyhow. When I was in college, oh, when I'm going to get job. Or ek din jana hi hai na job pe. Nee, I should get a good job, good job, good job. When I got, oh, I should get married, a good girl, I should get a good girl. Are milega yaar ek din, you're going to get, it's a cycle of life. It is going to come, this is not going to go. No, do any one of us, oh, I want old age. Oh, don't worry, one day everyone is going to go old. We are not asking, oh, I want old age. But it is going to come. Why worry for it? And very people generally, you know, have a complaint towards God. It's a butterfly story and a flower story. Once there was a man who asked God, a flower and a butterfly. But instead, God gave him a cactus and a caterpillar. Commonly, things which happen to us, you know. We also ask God. The man was sad. He didn't understand why his request was mistaken. He then thought, oh, well, God has too many people to care for, and he decided not to question. After some time, the man went to check up what has happened, and from the cactus came a beautiful flower had grown up, and the unsightly caterpillar had become into a beautiful butterfly. Endurance, faith, difficulties to faith. God always wants the right thing. He will give us the best. Have the faith that he is going to give you the best. It's not, you know, people generally have a question. Why am I not given this? I have written the CAT exam, my friend has written the CAT exam, he has passed, I have not passed the CAT exam. Why? I could not crack the medical entrance, my friend has cracked the medical entrance, why? Common questions, common things. We always have a complaint towards God, God you have not given. It's a nice story over here. Once, you know, God was, you know, you go to the temple, generally God is in a standing position, you know. So one devotee, you know, he was cleaning the temple, every day he used to come and clean the temple. He said, God, seeing you clean, you know, standing here, you must be tired, no? Kya karega? I'm God, I'm supposed to stand and take care of the people. No, one day you go and take rest, I will take care of your job. You take one day off. So God said, nene, aisani, nene, don't worry, I will not do anything. I'll just stand, that's all. Okay, then God told him, theek hai, since you are a very good, sincere servant of mine, I'll make you stand over here. Don't open your mouth. Don't say anything. Don't ever do anything. Just stand here. I have set everything right. I have set everything right. You don't have to do anything. Okay, no God, you don't worry, you leave. So the decided day came. God went on one day off. And this fellow was standing there like God. And first, you know, couple of people came, read his leg. First, a captain of a ship came. God, great, you are great, God. Today I am taking my ship, first time in the sea. I'm going to go. Okay. So he said, he was quite, he remembered God had told him not to open his mouth. He did not open his mouth. Okay, fine. He went off. Then one very rich person came. Very rich. God, I got a lot of factories, I got this, I got that. I'm opening a new project, 500 crore project I'm opening. I got to increase my business more. Please help me. And while falling down, his pocket fell down. You know, the purse from his pocket fell down. He did not notice that. He went off. Another poor person came. This person was a very nice person. He used to give a lot of donation to the temples and temples and everything. But this fellow had a very bad habit, was anybody was to ask anything, paisa utha ke de dene ka bhagwan. So this fellow came, Bhagwan, last 5 rupiah hai mere paas, abhi dal raha hu aapke hundi mein, khane ka vanda hai, I don't know what I'm going to eat now next. He goes down, sees a purse, he says, oh God, you have been so merciful, you have given me this money. Immediately, mere aaj abhi pucha, apne turan de diya. Keeps the purse, goes off. Then this sailor comes. The sailor comes, the third. There's a third person. He comes and falls down, God, I'm going for this. By the time the first businessman realizes that his purse is lost. And he goes and gives a complaint to the police. The police come and catch this sailor. And the sailor is caught. He said, you have taken the money. No, I have not taken the money. You have taken the money. Usko 20 ne paisa liya hai, mera paisa chori kiya hai, usko utha ke andar dalo. He was put behind bars. Oh, this fellow was watching as God. He said, no, this is going beyond limits. Now I have to do something. I have to break my silence. He said, nee, Bhagwan, police wala. No. Main Bhagwan hoon, main bol raha hu na. Ye chor hai, isne paisa liya tha. Isne paisa ghumaya tha, isne liya tha. You catch this person and leave that person. Police also solved the case. The right person who had taken the money was taken behind bars. The night God came. Said, oh, so what you did? Hey, God, I was, did your work perfectly? How was your rest day today? You had a nice rest? Yes, I had a nice rest. What, did you open your mouth? No, one incident I opened my mouth. Otherwise, everything went fine. No, what happened? He narrated the incident. This happened. Idiot, I told you, don't open your mouth. I had said things right. Then what was the need for you to open your mouth? The person, who was a rich person, used to never give donation. By the way of his purse falling down, at least he made some donation towards the temple or towards the poor person. The other poor person was such a nice person, he would give all the money to the temple. He used to never keep anything for himself. And he needed money. And for that person only had kept the money. And deliberately I wanted the sailor to get caught because the ship is going to get sunk. I have planned. You don't have to interfere. But generally, we have a tendency of interfering in God's planning. Have you ever asked a person who has missed the flight, which has crashed, how it feels to miss a flight? Have you ever thought of that? It's a very tragic thing which has happened. Kanishka flight. Many people in our circle, one of our friend, he missed the flight. And mind you, he saved today. He's alive even today. We generally tend to forget. If that, you know, we, oh God, the traffic jam, I struck, I missed the flight. If I miss the flight, I miss the meeting. No problem. Your life is more important. God is worried about your life, not your meeting. Meeting can happen later also. You may lose your job, you will get another job. Jaan hai to jahan hai. Many a times people, you know, things happen such a way that we feel, oh, my marriage was broken. The wo ladki se shaadi hone wala tha, break ho gaya. Achha hua. Baad mein divorce hone wala tha, usse pehle shaadi toot gaya, achha hai. Lord has his own plannings, his own way of working, things of working. Let's not intervene in that way and say, no, I will decide what is right for me. If your child doesn't get admission in medical, no problem. Doesn't get admission in engineering or in specific field, like in a CA field or any field, whatever you're trying to. Don't get disheartened. God has a planning. You mean to say those who have not become CAs are rotted in their life? Have never been successful in their life? Success has been there all throughout their life. It's not that only because getting that specific field, I will going to shine. No. That's the tragedy. 90% of the women who come, girls who come to Bombay to become heroines, we all know where they land up. You all know about it. This is their, you know, persistent desire. I'm not saying one should not be ambitious. One should not be persistent. But let God decide. Let's not cross His rules. And if we cross, definitely we have to pay a price for it. That's always the case. So God gives the best to those who leave the choice for Him. So then what does the factor depend on? Why are some people successful? Why are some people not? Two people write the medical exam, same years, get the same percentage, become doctors. One is having a line of patients waiting outside for him, and one doesn't have any patient for him. What is the reason? Both have studied the same university, same college, same year, same university exam they have passed. Both have got same percentage. Why is it so? The law of karma. This we are all forgetting. This is the reason why one child shines, another child doesn't shine. Let this be very clear. People generally have a feeling, no, if I study, I can do it by my own. No. It's not possible by your own effort. Lord talks in the 18th chapter, so five factors for a successful completion of an action. Again, that's another in-depth of the Bhagavad Gita, which I don't want to start now. But the point is, this law of karma works very, very stringently. Who chooses a job, a wife, husband, a type of car, an apartment, many things? Who decides? We don't choose. We may choose our apartment. We may choose our job. We may choose our wife. We may choose. But who chooses our parents? Who chooses our beauty? Who chooses our intelligence? Did you decide that in Villa Parle, in Hanuman Road, I want to take birth in so-and-so parents' place? Were you given a choice? Were you given a choice to be as beautiful as Aishwarya Rai or as a common lady? Were you given a choice for intelligence? I want to be as intelligent as Einstein. Were you given a choice? Choice was not given to you. It was given by force. Birth was given by force. Who chooses by them? Is it by chance? Why? Why do some children are born poor, some are born rich, some live in small huts, some in mansion? Have they decided? If a person was given a choice before birth, would you mean, you know, like, given to me a chance? Arre, bahut jindagi bhar I have taken a lot of birth as a rich man. This time let me born as a beggar in the signal. Do we take a choice? two people are born at the same time, same day. How do they decide? One is born in an Ambani's family's house and one is born at the beggar's house. Is there any choice? It's by force, as the law of karma works. Just think it out. It's something which we are seeing, but we are not realizing it. One is born handsome, one is born ugly. Why? Do we choose our beauty? No, I would like this birth I will be ugly, next birth I will look beautiful, or vice versa. This birth I will be beautiful and next birth I will be ugly. One is pumped up strong, one is like a skinny and bony. One gets to eat a lot, one dies of malnutrition. What's the problem? Where is he? What's gone wrong? Where is he gone wrong? This is a very common thing which is happening in front of us, but we don't understand, we don't realize it. Then what's the, why this difference? Why God is unfair to these people? God is partial? Ek ko khana khilaya, ek ko nahi khana khilaya, ek ko ameer ke ghar pe banaya, ek ko gareeb ke ghar pe, bhikari ke ghar pe banaya. Ek ko India mein diya, ek ko Syria mein bar diya. Getting tortured in Syria. This is very important. Arthur Ashe, you must have heard about him. He was a very good Wimbledon player. Dying of cancer, from world over, he received letters from his fans, one of which conveyed, why does God have to select you for such a bad disease? He has got cancer. To this, Arthur Ashe replied, the world over, 5 crore children start playing tennis. 50 lakh learn to play tennis. 5 lakh learn professional tennis. 50,000 come to the circuit. 5,000 reach the Grand Slam. 50 reach the Wimbledon. 4 semi-finals. 2 to the finals. When I was holding the cup, I never asked God, why me? And today in pain, I should not be asking God, why me? This is his own personal words, mind you. His own personal words. People generally have this tendency, you know, when I am successful, it's because of me. And when I am not successful, it's all the factors in this world other than me. I can never do any mistake. You know, it's like as if I got a stamp paper written from God. I can never commit mistakes. Everyone else can commit mistakes. I will never commit mistakes. This is a common problem. People generally don't understand why we are doing this. Where are we going wrong? So as you sow, so you reap. Old saying, jo boega, wahi kapayega. So we don't understand what we are doing, what seeds we are sowing, we don't know. Many times we are ignorant of that, what seeds we are sowing. This is all given in Bhagavatam. This all comes under Bhagavatam, high level lecture. You know, women like to expose, many women like to have, you know, showy dresses, exposure dresses. They are born as trees. For thousands of years, they have to be living as trees. You like to expose? God gives them the birth of a tree. This is where I have to relate you back to the soul topic. At the time of death, you are transferred back to this type of yoni. Those who like to eat nice meat, lot of eating meat. Why you want to have cooked meat? I'll make you a nice tiger. You can have raw meat. No, jhanjat pakane ka bhi jhanjat nahi hai. Those who want to sleep a lot, you know, many people have got a very dirty habit of lousily sleeping. Nice polar bear, it will make you a nice polar bear. Sleep nicely, sleep. And sometimes you are made into a nice python. No, those, some people are there. Koon jayega, dabba se khana nikal ke khayega, khana ghar, muh pe tak aajayega to achcha hai. You know, that attitude of people are there. For them, you know, nicely God makes you a nice python. Python never goes out searching for food. It keeps his mouth open. Jo aa gaya, kha gaya. So that is what the attitude is there, it comes. And then those who like very earth eat filthy things, you know, all junk food, junk stuff and everything. Nice pig, they will make you a nice pig. God makes you a nice pig. Lord clearly says in the 8th chapter, Yam Yam Vapis Pranam Bhavam Trajayatanta Kalevaram Tam Tam Eviti Kontiya Sada Tadbhav Bhavita. What you have consciousness at the time of death, same type of birth I will give you. God promises this. But Lord clearly says, if you think about me, I will give you a better birth. If you are not thinking about me, you are thinking about something else. And what happens is, whole life, what mentality you have developed, that is going to be the thinking at the time of death. This is a big problem. If we have got only money as our attitude, oh, I want money making. At the time of death also, how to make money, how much money I can make, that's the attitude. That doesn't change. That is the big problem. If that attitude changes, it's totally different. Now, you may say, what can I do? I am ignorant of the law. I should not be punished for ignorance of law. There's a very nice scriptural story in this. You must have heard of Mundak Rishi. Mundak Rishi, he was sitting in his ashram and doing tapasya. That time, the king's soldiers came. And one thief had come from the king's palace, and he came and hid himself in the Mundak Rishi's ashram. And the king's soldiers came and they were searching. And they decided, ashram mein, we have got those things from the palace, we have got the things. So this fellow is also involved in the chori. So they caught the thief, they caught this fellow also, Mundak Rishi also, and they took him. And Mundak Rishi was a very strong Rishi, mind you. And they took him over there. There, the king said, execute him. Even he did not bother to see who the Rishi was. Execute him. Okay. They were about to execute the chore and the Mundak Rishi. And suddenly Mundak Rishi felt, what's wrong? I am a Rishi. I have never done anything wrong of this sort. Why am I going to be butchered, rather literally going to be butchered. Suddenly, some from the jailer's people, they went and told the king, Maharaj, usme koi bada rishi hai, usko bhi marne wale hai kya? Suddenly, the king realized, oh, I'm not supposed to kill a brahmana, a rishi, I'm not supposed to kill. He calls him, says, oh, he's Mundak Rishi, I know him, he's a very big rishi. He says, no, I'm sorry, he takes pardon from him and leaves the king. And leaves the Rishi. The Rishi says, King, it's not your mistake. Something somewhere is wrong. I want to find out where something has gone wrong. Through his mystic powers, Mundak Rishi goes to Yamaloka. And he sees, he asks Yamaraj, what mistake I did? You gave me this punishment. I was about to be killed. Just a few minutes before my execution, I was saved. What was wrong? I'm such a big Rishi. Then he tells, see, he asks Chitragupta Maharaj goes through the whole book. He says, when you were a small child, you had a small grass, you know, stick of grass, and you were poking ants with that. That punishment has come to you at this age, at this level. He became very wild. How do you say, I am a small kid, I am not even able to crawl, I am just a crawling kid, and you are expecting me to behave properly, not to play with those ants? How do I know? I don't have the knowledge at that time. I was too small a person to understand that. That time he says, sir, this is the law of karma. Whatever you do has to come back to you. You didn't kill the ant. You were poking the ant by torturing almost near to death. So you also had to face the near to death experience. Of course, then he curses Yamaraj to become Vidura, and that's why he is born as Vidura in the Mahabharata. So that's the story behind it. But what's more important over here is how the law of karma works. It is very, very, very difficult. This Gahana Karma Gatim, the word used in Bhagavad Gita is Gahana Karma Gatim. We don't know what time, what did we to pay. You know, do you have any idea why Bhishma Pitamaha was lying on the bed of arrows? The Mahabharata, does anybody have an idea of it? Once, Vishnu, when he was lying on the bed of arrows, Krishna with other associates, that's Yudhishthira Maharaj, Arjuna, goes near him. So he asks Krishna, why am I suffering on this bed of arrows? For so many days I'm lying on this bed of arrows. What I did? And Vishnu was one of the Mahajanas, so he could have mystic powers to go back in the earlier birth and see what he has done. So he goes back to 100 births and he sees, I have not done anything wrong that I should suffer like this on a bed of arrows. Then Krishna says, I will give you more blessings. Go back 17 births more, that is 117th birth, what you did, you recollect and see. And there he saw Bhishma Pitamaha was a very arrogant, proud king. Very proud king. He was so proud that one day when he was walking out the courtyard, a snake came across his road. And he said, how dare this snake comes in front of me? Who can cross my road? So he takes up an arrow, lifts the snake and just throws it like that. And the snake goes and falls on a bush of thorns. And the more the snake was trying to come out, the more it was getting entangled in the thorns. That is why after 117 births, he got the punishment on the bed of arrows. This is the intricacy of karma reactions. That's one of the secret why one is successful and one is not. One goes ahead in race, you know, generally if you see one batch of students in a college or a school, average, they all are on the same level, on the same age group, same input, same teachers, everything same. But what is the use if their karma reactions are not the same? That is different. That is not going to be the same. That is going to vary from person to person. That is not going to be the same. What karma reaction I have done, what karma reactions you have done, each one has got his own individual way of understanding the things. So let's not say I was ignorant. It's like, you know, telling, I didn't know I cannot travel in a first class compartment with a second class ticket. Will the TC leave? If I enter into a no entry road, will the Havaldar leave me? You know, you are ignorant of the law. Say, paisa bharo, agli bar se yaad rahega, ye road mein nahi ghusne ka. Simple. Ignorance of a law is not an excuse of not knowing the law. You cannot escape from the punishment of the law. No, I was not ignorant that in this country, if I murder, I will be hanged. This is the law. Whether you know or you don't know, you have to abide by it. So similarly, one should know the law of karma. This is very important. Last but not the least, this is a very important point which we have to understand. Another major reason of stress, the biggest price we pay for material advancement. Let's not run behind material advancement. It's too high a time. We have run enough behind material advancement. Just achieving a bigger car, costlier iPhones, 5-star hotels, gadgets. You can even fill your belly in a small hotel. What's the need to go into a big hotel? And for that, what are the price you're paying? Just running behind money like mad and then incurring more headache, more stress. Actually, we are not working for ourselves. We are working for the MNCs. We are working for the mobile companies, for the hotels, for the auto companies and the banks. Each month, your salary, before it comes to your account, the EMIs are cut first. What is the big idea? Let's have necessities. I'm not saying one should not have necessities. But what's the big idea? If you are having a flat, a smaller flat, a small house, no problem. At least be happy that you're having a kid, you're having a wife, you're having a father, mother. Be satisfied with that. Instead of not being satisfied, we are worried about the other person's requirements. He is having a better phone. He is having a bigger car. So I should also have a 1000cc car or a 1500cc car, because he is having a 1500cc car. Tell me, with 1500cc car and with an 800cc car in Bombay's road, where can you fly? The potholes are different for a 1500cc car and the potholes are different for an 800cc car. It's craziness. As I told you, we compare gadgets. We are loving things and using people. That's the bottom line of the whole thing. And this is a too high a price. You know, this is a very important shloka from Bhagavad Gita 5.22. Very important shloka. Yahi samsparsha jaboga, dukkha yone revete. Lord is writing in the scriptures, dukkha yone revete. Adi anta vante konte na te su ramate buddha. This is the reason for dukkha. Things an intelligent person does not take part in the sources of misery, which are due to the contact of material senses. Mind you, this is not real happiness. This is only a perception of happiness. For example, Arjuna asks Krishna in the third chapter, why are people compelled to do sinful activities? You mean to say a person who is stealing, who is committing a murder, who is committing a rape, doesn't know it is wrong? He is very well aware of it, but still he commits the murder or the crime. The reason is lust. Kamesh, krodesh, rajagunam, maha ashno, maha papa, vidyayanam, ya vairinam. Lord clearly says this. Kam, lust alone. Lust is desire, hankering. I am having hankering for having a nice Sony Vivo laptop. I am having hankering for Mercedes Benz. This lust, I know, with this income of 50,000 rupees or 60,000 rupees a month, I cannot buy. So what do I do? I do corruption, I do stealing, I do all wrong practices. Just for what? Just to fulfill this. And the worst part is, next verse Lord clearly tells the intricacies of it. This is covers by different layers of lust we are covered, and which is an enemy for knowledge. Jnanina nitya vairinam kamarupena kaunteha dushpurena alena cha. This is something which we have to understand. Suppose you have a desire for an latest iPhone and you are able to buy that iPhone. Are you satisfied for lifelong with that stuff? Within 6 months, a new model is launched in the market. What are you going to do? No, I have got this, I am happy. No. You want to go for the latest model? So Lord clearly says, kama rupena kaunteya dushpurena alenacha. This is like oil, adding oil to the fire. This is not satisfying. One desire will lead to a chain of next desire. It is not going to get ended over here. It is only going to increase. And if it is not satisfied, you develop anger. Kamesh krodesh. You develop anger. No, I did not get this. I have to work more hard for this. So either, there are only two possibilities when you desire, when you have lust. Either it will be getting fulfilled or not getting fulfilled. If it is fulfilled, then also it is a problem, because it leads to a further desire. For example, now you got an 800cc car. From a scooter, you were desiring for a car. You got an 800cc car. From a car, now you desire, no, I should now have a 1000cc car. Now I should have a 1500cc car. So your desires are going on increasing. Vice versa, not fulfilled. I'm working for the past 5 years, I've not got more than a scooter. Let the law of karma work. You tell me, you are working for 30 years, 40 years to earn 2 crores. Just taking a birth of as a son of Amitabh Bachchan, I am getting 150 crores. Which is easier? Simple. If I am born as a son of Ambani or as a son of Amitabh Bachchan, aise hi 500 crore to mere jeb mein aise hi paida gaya chala gaya. Can you work for 50 years and earn 500 crores? By labor, hard labor. We are not able to buy one flat of 5 crores. Forget about 500 crores. And immediately 1 minute, so which is smarter? This is the law of karma. You cannot say, no, this is going to be like this. No. This is totally different. These are two different things we are trying to combine. Let every child, individual life, let it work the way things are going. Let's not try to cross the line. Oh, I wish I had got a job in a better school. I wish I had a better job in a better MNC office. Not possible. Everyone, if it was better, then who would be in the worst? It's a very common joke, you know. Every lady generally, you know, goes and buys a sari or a dress and then comes home and asks, hey, dress acha hai na? Once my wife asked me, I asked her, you went and asked the shopkeeper, give me the worst cloth in your shop. Did you ever go and ask, any lady would go and ask a shopkeeper, aapka dukaan mein sabse ghatiya kapda hai, wo mujhe do. Definitely not. And that doesn't mean the one you are not purchasing doesn't mean that is useless. It may not suit you, but it may suit somebody else. So let it be for somebody else rather than for yourself. Why you want to, or would I go to a shop and say, show me, give me the worst shirt in your shop? No. What I may like, I may buy. That doesn't mean the other person doesn't have a right to buy that shop. I mean, that shirt, another shirt. So let's have this concept very clear that our mind is the main problem and handling the problems. This is a very important thing. How do we handle the problem? Let's do a very simple experiment. This is a pot, a jug. And the jug, we put in first the big rocks. Then once that pot is filled, then we fill it with small rocks. Now there's no more place to put the big rocks. So we put the small rocks. Then we put in the sand so that we can fill the gaps in between the small rocks. Then we fill it with water. So everything is full packed. Big rocks, small rocks, sand, and then water. Now let's fit the same thing in the reverse order. The way in which we were doing, let's reverse the same thing. Let us fit the ingredients in the reverse order. First, we take the jug, fill it up with the water, sand, small sand, then the big rocks, the small rocks, then the big rocks. You cannot put in all the big rocks. It will not fit. You can try this experiment. You will not be able to fit the big rocks because the sequence was reversed. Same way it's our life, what we solve the problems. The big rocks are the real problems. The small rock and the sand are the relative problems. And the jug is our life. What are we doing? We are trying to solve the relative problems. The rain problems, the real problems, which I told you, birth, death, old age and disease, Adi Devik, Adi Bhautik and Adhyatmik. Those problems are kept aside and we are trying to solve the problems of my child is not studying well, my AC is not working, my car is not working, my house requires a repair, you know, small things. And we are taking tension for that. Right? Tension is like from the minute expectation is there. Expectation in the sense, when I come to the bus stop, I expect my bus should come first. And all unrealistic expectations. I go to the railway station, an empty train should come. I should just walk in. The seat should be ready for me. I should go and sit. All unrealistic expectations. But we have that expectation right from the day one. When you get up in the morning, we brush. We expect, the paste should be on the brush also. It doesn't happen. Real is totally different to expectations. And we have to accept the fact that what our expectations are. And neglect the real problems, we are neglecting the real problems. Let's try to solve that problems. Okay, now we are in the concluding part. Stop reacting and start responding. A small story. Once there was a nice party going in the hall. Nice party. So all the ladies were well dressed, well presentable. Suddenly from nowhere, a cockroach came. And it came on the dress of one of the ladies. And typically the ladies could react in a very nice way, yelling at the bottom of the heart, screaming. And the cockroach was also confused what to do. She's screaming so much. It flew and sat on another lady's dress. And there also, that lady also started screaming, shouting, yelling. Cockroach was more confused. So went and sat on a waiter's dress. One of the waiter was moving around with a plate and it came. Now here, the waiter immediately caught the cockroach, did not shout, did not yell, went out, opened the window, threw the cockroach out, closed the window. Now this is what we are supposed to do. We are supposed to respond to the situation and not react to the situation. But 99% of the time, we only react to the situation, we don't respond to the situation. We yell. First thing is, our child does not perform well, shout. Or beat. We have not got our thing, curse the boss, curse the whatever thing which has gone wrong, curse the person which has not come to our expectation. But the problem is, we are supposed to respond. Let's react to this, instead of reacting to the situation, let's start to respond to the situation. What is to be done? Okay, if your child has performed poorly, accordingly, let us upgrade his tuition or change his tuition teacher or what interest he is having, let us focus on that level. Instead of that, we are expecting the child to perform well in all the subjects or in all the fields. Respond to the situation. Don't just react to the situation. reacting to the situation is not a solution to the problem. How do I, just by shouting or yelling or by losing my anger, I'm just going to increase my blood pressure. I'm going to increase my stress level. It's not going, is it going to solve my stress? No. It's only going to create my stress. But the same thing is, if I ask the person, okay, I go to the counselor, I go to the teacher, ask what is to be done, what is this child to be done. Because each child has got its own individual capacities. Again, I'm repeating the same thing, but in a different manner. And this is what we do. We only react. We only see problem as a big calamity. Let's solve the problem. Any problem is there. Life is all full of problems, mind you. It's only movies, 3 hours, we see illusion. We see in a movie total illusion. Oh, everything is rosy. In actual life, nothing is rosy. Everything is black. Everything is hard. Right from morning, preparing the dabba, to the night, going to the bed, everything is a tough time. Nothing is rosy. You mean to say the boss is, the expectation is, the boss is going to give you a garland, give you, please come inside. Does it happen? But expectation is the other way around. Everything is ulta. Expectation is ulta, reality is ulta. And we expect things to go very smoothly. I'll go and stand in the railway station, the train will come, I'll go in and get down, immediately the bus will be standing, I'll go in, the boss will invite me, please come in. Nothing. Everything goes very slowly and very steadily. And we have problems are there very systematically. Okay, now the last ABC of internal bodybuilding. Now, this whole session till now, we understood the problem is in the mind, in our thinking. This is what we have to get this very clear. Now, our funny expectation is, a very nice example. One of my friends, we were discussing, school friends, and one fellow is telling the other fellow, you know, I've started going to yoga classes, and I know, very nice relief I got. Bola, acha? Kya hua? Nahi, pehle main 2 pack jaru pita tha, abhi 4 pack daru pita hun. Is this what we are supposed to use the Vedic knowledge for? Is it not a tragedy? Yoga was meant by the used by the yogis those days for doing bhakti, not for increasing their alcohol content in the body. This is a real trend what we are seeing nowadays, very, very tragic. Stress management is mismanaged very nicely. Doctors generally have a solution. Oh, get up early in the morning and walk. My problem is in the hand. If I walk, my hand will become all right. Stress is in the mind. What is to be done for the mind? Okay, these are all solutions given aside, fine. Actually, first and foremost, how do I stabilize my mind? How do I make my mind steady? In the third chapter, in the sixth chapter, Arjuna asks Krishna, how do I steady my mind? I can control the wind, but I can't control the mind. This is Arjuna is saying, 5,000 years before. And today, we Kali Yuga people are the most useless people. We can't remember anything. We can't even remember a mobile number. He remembered the entire Bhagavad Gita which was spoken to him, 700 verses. So what he did? Lord says, Abhyas and Vairagya. Practice and renunciation. First, till now what I was discussing to you is, limit your expectations. Enough is enough. Be happy. Rehna kitna hai? 75 years jeena hai na? Permanent 1,000-2,000 saal toh jeena nahi hai. We are not going to live for 1,000-2,000 years. We are going to live for 75 years. That's the maximum nowadays. I'm talking of an extended warranty period. We don't have that much of lifespan also nowadays. And that 25 years goes in educating the child. What is the life left? With the breakup of the lifespan, if you see, it's very funny. Average, let's say, 75 years life. Out of that, straight away, 1/3 goes in sleeping. Average, we sleep for 6 to 8 hours. So 1/3 is gone. So let's say 25 years is gone. Say 20 years is gone in sleeping. 20 years goes in studying. 40 years gone. Balance whatever in that years you have to work, marry, produce children, bring them up, settle them up. For that 30 years or 35 years, why break your head? And anyhow, Lord says, after death, you're going to get a new body. Again, vapas ABCD se start karna hai. Why? What's a big hurry? Rather, we do understand the scriptures, have a scriptural angle of working on things, it is better. And this is very important. Association of spiritualists, books that nourish the intelligence, and chanting. Mantra. What is the full form of a mantra? Manatrayati iti mantra. That which delivers the mind. The problem here how we have identified is the mind is the problem. Our mind is always in worry, tension, in some form or the other. Because of this worry, we are stressed. So what we are supposed to clean, or rather what we are supposed to steady, is the mind. So we are supposed to chant, meditate. This is what is the main key of success. And secondly, reading spiritual books. That is more important for studying the spiritual books. This will give you the knowledge to steady your mind. And last, not the least, association. Now, if I am going to sit with all useless people, with useless-minded people, I'm not people, a person is never useless, mind you. Thinking makes a person useless. No, the general saying, show me your friends and I will tell you what you are. It's like that. Have like-minded, common-sense people, not people who are giving you prejudiced mind. Oh, this is like this. Don't do like this. Put your son in this college. Put your son in this school. I have seen parents dying for having that specific college, for the specific school. Hurry. In that school, is it 2 plus 2 is 4, and here it is 2 plus 2 is 5. Everywhere they're going to be, math is going to be the same. 2 plus 2 is going to be 4. It's not going to be 5. But still, we have got a reverse calculation of the whole book altogether. So basically, this is what we want to sum up. Now, I would like to all to go for any questions. If you are having any queries on this whole session, I would like you to go ahead. Yes. Please take the mic.
Nowadays, I think the biggest problem faced by all the parents and teachers is how to discipline a child. Children are becoming very arrogant. They do not listen to us, very indisciplined. So how could we?
Very nice question. It's a very sensible question and a question required for today's date. You know, my teacher always tells me, there's an old saying in the school, money lost, nothing is lost. Health lost, something is lost. Character lost, everything is lost. But today, it's the reverse. Character lost, nothing is lost. Health lost, still something is lost. But money lost, everything is lost. This is where our problem lies. What are we doing to build up character in the children right from childhood? Have we taken any efforts? Is there any subject? We are talking of EVS, we are talking of environmental science. Today I have been presumed even sex education has been brought into the thing. Even animals don't need sex education, even they reproduce without sex education. The tragedy is, what education is required is not being given to the children. We have taken it from the modern Western culture as it is, without applying it to the Indian level, Indian system. Vedic civilization or Vedic education will give you the answer to this problem. In our younghood days, we used to have this problem. Vedic education used to be there. First and foremost, a child used to be taught to respect the parents. Today, where are we teaching that? Get up, go and study, become a good animal. Two-legged animal, as I explained to you earlier. First class, two-legged animal. Eating, sleeping, mating, defending. Four things we are pumping into the child very nicely. And we don't want to go anything more ahead of that. We are happy. With that much of education, we are happy. We think, okay, with this education, my child can earn a bread. But why are we worried? I still don't understand. We are worried about the future of the child. Lord says, an ant is also fed. A crow is also fed. He is not going to go to any school. He has not studied any college. He has not studied any education. He is not working for any MNCs. Even an elephant which requires 40 kilos of food at a time, even he is fed in the jungle. Tell me, which animal sleeps hungry? Is there any animal which is sleeping hungry? We are also becoming very good animals. We are not interested in getting ourselves educated in the Vedic way. And the worst tragedy in India is being born in India, a country where Vedic knowledge has been in the blood, we are now disregarding it and taking up which is rejected by the West. West are taking up the yoga system, West are taking up the Vedic system. They are trying to understand this Vedic scriptures. Go to Germany, they are the best Vedic scholars. Best Sanskrit, if you study Sanskrit today, first you are picked up in by Germany. Germany picks you up. Why they are best in your homeopathy. They are the best because they are interested in Vedic scriptures. They read the Sanskrit rules, books and everything. Whereas we are not interested. We are interested in all Western kachara. And what Western kachara? We have now taken from them how to eat pizzas, how to drink a lot of alcohol. A question what you were asking, the same relevancy. 25 years before, if a person wanted to drink alcohol, he used to cover his head and go quietly in the middle of the night to an alcohol drinking place and drink. Today, it's the prestige. And the worst part is seeing ladies drinking. The proverb was, very old proverb is there. Hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. If this hand itself is rocking, what she will rule the world? What are you going to produce when you yourself are not aware of the knowledge? It's high time that we as a youngster generation take up this Vedic knowledge, understand it, not just for ourselves, to give it down the lane to the children. Our children should also understand that. Our children should also understand, oh, this knowledge is required. Today, parents are not bothered. My son is smoking, no problem. He should become an engineer. My son is drinking, no problem. You know, her son is also drinking. So-and-so son is also drinking. So let my son also drink. And then what are you going to do? You are going to land up into an old age home. That's for sure. That's guaranteed. Because you have not developed any culture inside him. No character building has been done inside the child. In 8 subjects or 9 subjects in the school, class we are having, which talks about character building? Tell me that. We are talking of only education, science, maths, history, geography, all gross things. We are not talking of anything which is subtle. Rama and Mahabharata, they were using weapons which were not require gross weapons to be used. Only by mantras they used to fire, and fire used to come out, water used to come out. Here what we have done, big bombs we have to carry by plane and drop it. And that is a low grade of science. Science was much advanced during those times than these times. In what way have we flourished? And tell me, taking Western technology, people may say, oh, I put on one switch and the light comes. Tansen used to sing and the light used to burn. So which was better? He used to never pay electric bill also. He was fukat mein chalta tha. Today we have to pay electric bill. So which is better? It is better that we have a higher level of thinking than having a lower level of thinking. Today, if you see science, people say science is advanced. In what way? Today we were only having mobile bill. Now internet bill is added to the mobile. So you are paying more to the companies every time. By in the name of app, you got to have a internet connection to that. So earlier it was only an incoming call and outgoing call. Today, incoming, outgoing, internet. I don't know in future what is going to come more. Everything has only increased. Our expenses have increased. Today, you go to the doctor, he gives you 10, 20 tests. He writes you, gives you 20 tests. And in the end, all reports are normal. Then what is the problem? No, all reports are normal. That means that you for that only you are giving me all the tests. And then the problem? No, that will be remain. We'll give some other medicine. Today, medical science is working on a test of exclusions. Mind you, this is what the principle is working on. Test of exclusions is, you don't have typhoid, you don't have malaria, you don't have this thing. Oh, that means you are having flu. This is gross foolishness. No, I don't know. You may have malaria, so I will test for malaria, I will test for this thing, I will test for this thing, I will test for cancer also. Oh, you are not having any of these diseases. Oh, you are having flu. No problem. You take 2 days flu medicine, you will become all right. This happened with me. This has happened to me. The doctor could not identify. I was having high fever. I was not able to identify what's the problem with me. He telling me, I'll give you medicines for viral fever. Let's see what happens. If I survive, I'm going to tell him what. This is a gross problem. The medical science is now on black and white. It's on a relative basis. It is not on a clear-cut basis. Okay, this is a problem. Earlier, doctors did not have these many gadgets. They could solve the problem much easier, much better. Any other questions? I hope I have answered your questions. Let's develop character. Character building is highly required. That's the most requirement of today. And character building can be done only through Vedic education. Vedic education was totally focusing on character building. It was never focusing on gross material things. It is opposite what Vedic system talks and what material science talks. Material science always talks of things, you buy this thing, you will be happy. You see an ad in the TV, you put on that TV and just see an ad. 5 minutes mein kya kya ad aata hai? Face cream, soap, eating noodles, eating this. Kabhi dal chawal ka ad aaya hai? But finally what you require is dal chawal. Dal chawal roti sabji, the main common ingredient what everyone has. Does any ad of those things comes? Nothing. You will get only use of all other peripheral things, which you don't require, only they are advertised. Things you don't require at all, only they will be, because they have to be pushed. We never used to have biscuits when we were kids. We used to have only roti, so we were physically more strong. Today we are eating biscuits, bread, all junk food. What is happening? Today you see obesity has become a very big problem in the society. Very big problem, especially in children. You see children in the age bracket of around 15 or 18, the maximum obesity is there. And the reason is very clear. Only because of eating this fast food and junk food. That's what we are seeing. Very nicely it is mentioned. I will take this opportunity. My teacher has come. Just now he has come because he is having a Janmashtami program. He has just walked in. So I request him to speak a few words because he is my teacher, so he can speak much better than me.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Yes.
Just enlighten, just
talking
about the material life, how nice material life is,
yeah,
and the look of it, but how torturous it is in the long run.
Yeah.
You know, how the patchworks of things are going.
I'm first of all very happy that you have given this opportunity to ISKCON for addressing and you know, the real problems which we all have. So I'm very much happy, and with thanks to the school for organizing all these things and all wonderful teachers and students, and I think so parents also there. So we'll say three times Hari Bol for them. Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. And this is the basic course in ISKCON. We have 3-day Bhagavad Gita course which basically deals of how to apply the Vedic knowledge or the Bhagavad Gita in day-to-day life. Like just now Mataji was speaking about, you know, the child problem. Many other problems will be there that today people are not listening. The character building or the goodness level. In Bhagavad Gita, 3 modes of natures are spoken. Passion, ignorance and goodness. So we have to develop goodness level more in the people. And Bhagavad Gita speaks that if goodness levels means we have to first bring 4 things in control. No intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex life, and no meat eating. Unless and until, you know, these four things are not controlled, you cannot bring goodness in a people. Another thing that Bhagavad Gita speaks is that food should become pure. Because what type of food you eat, that type of your consciousness, that type of your mentality becomes. If you want that the children should be listening, food should change. Because what food goes inside, that type of blood becomes. And that goes in your consciousness. If he is eating an ignorant way of food, Bhagavad Gita 17 chapter, 18 chapter describes the variety of the foods. What is goodness food? What is passionate food? What is ignorance food? If you eat ignorant food, which comes in a non-veg, which comes in, you know, all type of food, pungent, which is left after cooked after 3 hours. You know, passionate food is called as salty, spicy, hot. It is said that it gives three things in advance: roga, shoka, moha. And for goodness food, it is written pulse, rice, dal, sabji, all that, and milk, fat, cow ghee, all that comes in goodness food. So unless and until the food is not changed, and you know, the thinking, the intake of the people will not change. If a problem is inside and you are trying to address the problem from outside, the solution will not come. So we basically, in a child has, you know, in Bhagavad Gita it is said, we have gurus. Father and mother are the first guru of the child. What they learn from the house, they show in their life. So, we have to see where is the problem. We have to go to the root of the problem. Unless and until the root of the problem is not solved, it is very difficult. So, first of all, we have to identify the problem and then we have to solve it. Goodness level has to be increased. Unless and until the goodness level among the teachers, among the parents, among the students, if it is not increased and you are only trying to relate on the passion and on ignorance mode, Bhagavad Gita speaks, it is an animal life. If a dog is sitting, a cat is sitting, and you know, some other animals are sitting, and you speak to them about peace, that we want to have peace, what they will understand? At least, we have to bring them to the human level. And human level means goodness level. And goodness level means no meat eating, no gambling, no intoxication, no illicit sex life. Another main problem Bhagavad Gita identifies is mind. We take bath every day. Is it necessary or not? How many of you take bath every day? It's a what joke, huh? Everybody takes. Achha, one day you don't take bath, how will you feel? How will you feel? Not nice, na? Right. If you don't take one week bath, how will you feel? Horrible. Right? And 1 month. No, Prabhuji, what you are talking? We have to take it. No, Bhagavad Gita speaks about these things. Like, outer body cleaning is more important. Why? It is necessary. If we don't clean, we will, you know, it will be very uncomfortable for us to work out. We have to take 2 times, 3 times bath in a day. Similarly, internal cleaning, Bhagavad Gita says, is more important. Internal cleaning is more important, and internal cleaning consists of subtle body. There are three bodies which we have. The gross body, what we see, the subtle body, and the spirit soul. So we have to understand that the cleaning of subtle body that consists of mind, intelligence, and false ego has to be cleaned. And that is what we dealt. That if the mind, Bhagavad Gita 6th chapter, it clearly says, who is your greatest enemy? It says it is your mind which is your greatest enemy. And mind, if not cleaned properly,
it will create more problems than solutions in your life. So with body cleaning, mind cleaning has to be there. We teach about outer things, but not the internal things. We have to identify our enemy. That if we are not cleaning the mind, it becomes our enemy. Like food for the body is required, cleaning for the mind is very much required. And the solutions is given. And we have to understand who we are. We being spirit soul. Our identity, there are two parts. Gross body and spiritual things. We have to balance our life. We have to bring. Today, we are more grossly on the outer side. And we forget the spiritual needs. We forget our internal needs. And we think about only outer things. And that is where we commit a mistake. You know, you want that students should listen to you. Like Prabhuji told, the character is required. But character doesn't happen in one day. It doesn't happen. It should be within ourselves also. It should be with the parents also. And then we can insist the students also. In Bhagavad Gita, the predictions are very bad. In Bhagavatam, that the things will become worse to worse as the day goes down. As the day goes, in Bhagavatam, there is a 12th canto which clearly says how the things will go bad to worse in Kali Yuga. It is not going to become easy life just by working on it. So we have to identify how our children can become more intelligent, how we can become more productivity, how we can teach the children to, you know, fight the real problems of the life. Not only making, and for that we have to input additional character classes. Additional character classes should be there. And how students who are practicing such life, we have to show them an example also. Because you have to have an example. If you don't have an example, how is it that you will tell him? People have examples of Sachin Tendulkar. People have the examples of many film stars. But they do not have an example of a student who is a character wise. He will see that student, then he will apply. Otherwise, it's not possible. An example has to be there. And we have to set that out. We have to bring a balance between our spiritual life and material life. That is required. The spiritual part is missed out. Any questions? Yes.
Either the whole crowd has understood everything or understood nothing. So please don't make
embarrassed. Hare Krishna. Bhagavad Gita or Sanatan Dharma is one of the philosophies of Hindu Dharma, and there is another path, another sect which is called Charvak or Lokayat, which just tells exactly opposite of Bhagavad Gita, which is also a Hindu philosophy. What do you think about that and how it is relevant to today's life?
See, first of all, we have to understand that spiritual knowledge is a very vast topic, and like there is an authorized way of receiving a spiritual knowledge. Like your school, is it afflicted to Bombay University? But there are many private school or private classes which may not be afflicted to government, and government may have not recognized it. There are many such institutes also. Their imparting of knowledge and your imparting of knowledge, what is the difference? The difference is you are following what the government has prescribed, authorized way. Similarly, in Vedic culture, Padma Purana, Lord Shivji clearly says that there are only four authorized way of receiving Vedic knowledge in Kali Yuga.
from the parampara. That is called guru disciple succession. Other all sampradaya vihinasya mantra vifala. So you're talking about the charvak philosophy. It doesn't come under the authorized scriptures. It doesn't come fit unto the authorized what the parampara with Shri Parampara, Madhva Gaudiya Parampara, Rudra Parampara and Kumara Parampara, which are authorized parampara. They never speak about this type of philosophies. So we have to understand that what philosophy this person has spoken, is it authorized? No, it is never authorized. It doesn't fall in the authorized scriptures. Secondly, he is speaking about body. But are we body? What are we?
Yes.
Okay. So can you tell me one simple thing, Prabhuji, the things belongs to you, are you that? Like the shirt which you are wearing, it belongs to you, sir. Are you the shirt? No. Okay. But you say it is my shirt, right? The chair which you are sitting inside, is it your chair or you are the chair? It is your chair, but you are not the chair. Principle, Vedic principle says the things that belongs to you, you are not that. The pant belongs to me, but I am not the pant. The watch belongs to me, but I am not the watch. Similarly, we have to apply the same thing on a body. The head, we say the head belongs to me. But are you the head? Okay, this hand belongs to you. But you can say I hand. Do you say I hand? What do you say? My hand. Okay. So are you the hand? No, you're not the hand. This chest belongs to you. But are you the chest? No. I'm not the I don't say I chest, I head. Okay. This stomach belongs to you, but are you the stomach? The leg belongs to you, but are you the leg? Okay. So this body belongs to whom? Who are you? No. Now you are not the head, you are not the hand, you are not the leg. Then are you the body? You say I body or my body? What do you say? Then if you say my body, then who are you then? Because the things that belongs to you, say my pen, my chair, my car, my hand, my head. Now you say I am not the head. I say it is my head, but I am not the head. You say it is my hand, but I am not the hand. You say it's my stomach, but I am not the stomach. You say it's my leg, but I'm not the leg. So if you are not the leg, if you are not the hand, then what are you?
These are all philosophical questions and it doesn't help me in my day-to-day life.
No.
When I'm hungry, I have to work hard.
Yes. No. The first thing I'm asking yourself, who are you? If you are not this body, then who are you?
This question doesn't make sense when I'm hungry.
No.
It will my body.
No. It will make sense, sir. There are two requirements. At the time of death, can you tell me? At the time of death, can you tell me why we say that the person has gone? Chala gaya. Why we say that the person has gone? I say it is there only. His head is there, leg is there, everything is there. Why you say is gone? What has gone? So why to speak soul about that time? If he is the soul and body is there, so when there are two different things, na? It is not one thing. Body is there, revive the body then. Revive it. Why you say the person has gone, he's left? I can see him over there. So there are two things. soul and body. And at the time, the problem is that at the time of death, we speak about soul. Entire life, what we are not. I am not this hand, I am not this leg, I am not this stomach, I am not this body. But I will speak only of body. But at the time of death only I will speak about soul. Uski soul, atma ko shanti mile. What? And on the photo we will put some shloka. Or then we will do the kriya. But during the entire lifetime we do not do anything for the soul. And we think the soul and body is one. We think soul and body is one. And Bhagavad Gita and Vedic knowledge, first things, who are you? Please identify yourself. You think that 50 years back you may have taken birth. But the day when we had taken birth, anybody gave you some name? Or you told that it is my name? Up to 6 days we don't have name. Nobody has name. Some mother or some relatives or someone gives you a name. So my question is that Udharanam we take. What is your name then? You have started identifying by that name. But who are you? At the time of death only we talk about soul. But without the soul, this body has no value. Moment the soul leaves, what will happen? No value. So the first thing that we have to understand, there are two things. That the things that belongs to me, I am not that. This body belongs to me, but I am not the body. Hand belongs to me, the stomach belongs to me, but I am not the stomach. I am different. And being spirit soul, the requirement of the spirit soul and the bodies are different. We only see one side of the life, and that is body. And we are not that. And when we only focus on that, it is like an example is given about a car and a driver. The requirement of the car is different, and the driver is different. You cannot say that driver will be happy if I put petrol in the car. If I wash the car, you know, the driver will be happy and I don't take care. So similarly, the requirement of your body is there. It is not there. But at the same time, you have a spiritual requirement also because you are spirit soul. Yes?
Only after fulfilling my body requirements, I can think about the soul.
Balance we have to bring. We have to bring balance. I'm not saying. We have to learn the balance part, and first of all, we have to admit one thing, who we are. You are not this body, because hand is yours, but are you the hand? Yes? Yes, stress everything. See, Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita
basically, management is that. How you take the advantage of this stress? Because you cannot eliminate stress to zero level.
Very nice, very nice. Bhagavad Gita speaks about mind. What it speaks? That mind is the problem. And mantra meditation is given for the stress. What is given? Mantra meditation. So we have to learn. See, like if I have a body problem, I go to a doctor who knows about this body very nicely. Similarly, when we have the subtle problems, internal problem, spiritual problem, we have to go to a spiritualist doctor who deals with it. Every part is having a different requirement, and we have to understand the balance between that. First basic part, we have to understand who we are. Unless and until that identity crisis is not solved, the goal is not set. The goal of the life is not set. Can anyone tell me the part has been taken? Animal difference and human difference? Yeah. Animal part and the human part difference has been taken? Huh? What is the difference between animal life and human life? Now, nature, by nature, I always give an example in the 3-day class that a peon is sitting and a manager is sitting. Both are working in a same firm. But why the difference of facility to the peon and a manager? Can anybody answer? In for one firm, one manager is sitting and is given all facilities, and peon is sitting outside. Why boss is given different facilities, even though he is working in the same firm? Because job. Any other word which you can add? Qualification. What else?
Function is different.
Responsibility. Very nice. Higher responsibility fetch you higher facilities in your life. When you take higher responsibilities, what it fetches you? Higher facilities. That manager, if he is taking the facility, but he is not fulfilling his responsibilities, what will happen? What the boss will do? He will fire him up and say, you do not fit to become a manager because you are not performing your responsibilities properly. You are using all the facilities for your personal things, but not performing your, you have become chaprasi. Similarly, nature is equal to everybody. Bhagavad Gita speaks, there are 84 lakh species. How many species? 84 lakh yoni. All species, the highest facility that nature provides is to humans. All humans. Lord is equal to everybody. Nature is equal to. But why is that the highest facility is given to humans? Because responsibility of humans is greater than animals. Greater than animals. What is the function of an animal and function of human beings? There are four common functions which we say between animals and human beings. Eating, sleeping, mating and defending. We also eat, they also eat. They eat in a different way, we eat in a different way. Sleeping, they also sleep, we also sleep. They also produce children, they also take care of the children. And the fourth part is protection. We also protect in our way, animals also protecting. So these four are commons. But the Shastra says higher intelligence is given for higher purpose. Higher intelligence is not given only for eating, sleeping, mating and defending. And what makes difference from the human, from the animal, is it is said, dharma adhika visheshu, dharma hina pashuhi samana. Means, higher understanding of higher life, that higher intelligence is given for higher understanding who I am, why I am over here. I do not want to suffer in my life. Why people are suffering, where I have came from, after death where I have to go. For that, at least human, you know, animals are doing this four activities, eating, sleeping, mating. But if you have higher intelligence and you only and only use your intelligence for eating, sleeping, mating and defending yourself, so you are in par with an animal. You are in par with an. So by nature, what happens, even if you are given higher intelligence and we use it only for these four things, then the nature starts taking back the facilities from you. Why? Because you want to live a life in par with animal. Then why should we give you the facilities? Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Animals eat what is available in the nature. And that is, animals do eat whatever is available in the nature readily.
Yes.
And human being, he has to create his food, he has to create the wealth to survive. He doesn't eat whatever is available in the nature as it is.
Uh-huh.
And for that, that additional intelligence is given.
So, additional intelligence is given to eat in a sophisticated way. And
create.
So, if he puts one seed, do you guarantee that one seed that becomes 1,000 seed, it is he making?
Yes, but he doesn't go to the jungle and eat the fruits from the plants.
No, no. Activities are same. Energy activities of eating is same. the animal, the bird also has to go out. It is not that he doesn't have to go out to bring for food for the child.
Bird doesn't do farming.
Huh?
Birds and animals doesn't do farming.
See, farming has to be done. Farming, water is required. Who is providing the water? Who is growing from one seed to 1,000 seeds? One seed you throw, are you making it 1,000? Who is providing the water? Are you providing the water? We have to admit that things, that facilities are given not for just eating, sleeping, mating and defending, but the intelligence is there for higher cause, higher purpose. It is not only for these four things. And for that, see, we have come in the school over here to understand that there is a problem. And Bhagavad Gita speaks about two problems. One is real problem of life and one is, you know, the relative problem of life. What is a relative problem? Relative problem is a problem which one person has, but that becomes a solution for other. Like we have a car. If it gets accident, it is a my problem. But the garage wala every day wants that at least something should come. It is not a problem for him. It is a solution for him. Now it is raining. You know, the umbrellas wala may be praying that it should rain. Why? Because it is their business. If we have a fight in a house, husband, wife, it's our problem. But the lawyers in the family court are waiting. Why they are waiting? Because it's a solution for them. So, Bhagavad Gita sees these are relative problems. What are they? Which is a problem for one person, solution for. But besides this problem, there are real problems of life. Which is equal to everybody. And for solving that real problems, higher intelligence is given. What is the real problem? Death. How much we plan, we have to die one day. Birth. Birth is also described. Plus, natural, you know, your adidaivik, adibhautik, adhyatmik. The birth, death, old age. Old age. Everybody will have to come at old age. And we have to suffer that. Then, old age, then disease. Nowadays, the rate of disease that are increasing are very high. So we have to understand that there are real problems which Bhagavad Gita speaks, real character building that Bhagavad Gita speaks. If we want that students should have character, at least some character should be in ourselves, in teachers also. Then we can help them to mobilize. And we cannot only take one part of life, that is the material, bodily part, but there is a spiritual aspect. Without the spirit soul, you know, you cannot function. And it is very less intelligent to talk that I will speak only at the time of death about soul. Atma chala gaya. What we say? But like the car and the driver, both requirements are different. Body and spirit soul, both requirements are different. It is not one. So, it may go on continuing. This is no end. But this is just a trial session that in one day if I put all the PhD classes, you know that students will get bored. So it is not, we have to systematically. And like you are teachers, the student has to be submissive to you. It should be submissive to you. Then you impart him knowledge. Right? If he is not submissive, aggressive to you, how nicely you can teach him? Is it possible for you to teach that aggressive student? That's why in Bhagavad Gita I say, pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. The student should be submissive, humble and submissive. Then he can learn something from, whether it is material knowledge or spiritual knowledge. So we have to understand the requirements. There are two requirements. Body requirement is there. But with body requirement, spiritual requirement is also there. Goodness level has to be increased. Passionate and ignorance level, if increases, life becomes hell. for ourselves also and for students also. So we have to bring a level, and for that slowly and systematically, it is not one day. If you want to become a doctor, you have to go through a lot of, you have to at least first enter in KG, and on that day only if I start giving doctor knowledge, it's not going to work. In KG we have to give 1, 2, 3, we have to teach them. Then we say the light travels in straight, then later we say no, light doesn't travel straight, it travels in waves. So according to the different level, when a person goes, we give him different understanding. One day it can't, but basically we have to understand, yes, problem is there. We have to identify the problem is there. And the way the people are dealing today, problem is aggregating. There is no goodness level. We have to admit that. Like students, teachers, school, money-wise, you know, everything is aggregating, it is not reducing. Our mental tension is not reducing. That we have to accept. So somewhere we have to take Vedic guidance and spiritual guidance also. That if imparting that part in our life, does it help us in tolerating the things? Doesn't help us to find a new way? So basically we have to impart in ourselves and impart the same thing in students. Hare Krishna. Yes.
Yeah, one more thing I would like to mention about my teacher, that in spite of his busy schedule in Janmashtami, we have got a big program in Janmashtami in our temple. He had a big, meeting for all the board of directors. And this, in spite of that, he has taken us time and given us some valuable moment. We are really thankful to him for this. And also the topic was, he was talking about the nature part. There is the three modes of nature: goodness, passion and ignorance. I think he must have taken around hundreds of class regarding that. And if you are lucky, we can request him to conduct one class for that. It will really come to know where we are in ignorance, passion or goodness. That is, in Bhagavad Gita, it's mentioned at Rajagun, Tamogun and Satogun. It's a very important topic, and he's a master, he's simply great in that. The way he takes it, we really love to understand the topic. So let's see, if we get a chance, we will request Prabhuji to take it in. Hare Krishna.
I would like to invite President of PTA to felicitate Guruji.
He's going.
Please.
The meeting is there.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. The principal, Mrs. Sudha Nair, of primary section of Madhura Bhagavat High School, English Primary School. Well, Guruji. Thank you very much for your valuable words. Let us understand ourselves first. Let us not come up with unrealistic expectations from children or from anyone. Let us understand the definition of success very closely. Let us not run in reverse manner. Let us learn to love the people and spread happiness everywhere, wherever we go. Let us give space to children and people around us. Let us understand the cultural background of our nation. And let us be good human beings, love each other, spread happiness and progress. Thank you very much.